Roll, Bobby.
Mr. Bacon?
Here.
Mr. McGee?
Here.
Mr. Pendleton?
Here.
Noting Dr. Mann is absent and Mr. Parker's absent.
Ms. Sutter?
Here.
I'm here. We will begin by having our elections in the various positions for the Planning Commission. We'll start by, and this is fairly informal. If there's a position that you're interested in, say it out loud and ask for somebody to nominate you. This is, excuse me. We're going to elect the 2024 chair first. Any nominations?
I nominate Kevin Murphy.
I second.
Thank you. Properly nominated and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Great. Thank you very much. I appreciate the vote of confidence. Next is the 2024 vice chair. Does anyone have a nomination to make?
I nominate Kim Sutter.
Second.
Properly nominated and seconded. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Excellent. Congratulations.
Happy to serve.
Serve. Year three, right?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Too late now because it's year three for me too.
We came in together.
Next we'll move into electing a representative to the Architectural Review Board. Commissioner McGee has held that position for in upwards of 2 years now, and has served on ARB before that. Are you interested in continuing to serve?
I think it's time to pass the baton.
Okay. Is anyone around this table interested in becoming the representative to the Architectural Review Board?
I'm interested. I'd nominate Larry Pendleton.
Excellent. And I had conversations with Lee LeVan also, and she's willing to serve if we need someone in that role. But I'm glad to hear that we have someone here who's interested in serving that role. Is there a nomination?
Yeah, I nominate.
Okay, that was a nomination. Thank you. I properly nominated and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Larry, thank you very much. Do you know what you're getting into?
Well,
Susan after the meeting.
Oh, that's great.
It's I think it's invaluable education, and you'll learn a lot that you apply at Planning Commission, and I'm sure you'll bring a perspective that benefits the board very much.
Thank you.
Next would be an election to the Public Art Commission. Commissioner Van currently has had that role for 2 months, I think. She seemed indifferent whether or not she wanted to continue in that role, and was willing to take on ARB. is there anyone around the table now who is interested in serving in that capacity? Okay. I'm not personally enthusiastic about electing someone who is not here to that position. So I would suggest that we table that until we have a full slate of commissioners here, or at least one who's willing to take on that role.
I support that.
Yeah.
Do we need to vote on that to continue that item?
It's a vote to continue it, but I guess just direction for staff. Do you want that at your mid-month meeting or your next meeting? 2 weeks or 4 weeks?
Let's put it on the next meeting agenda. I'm not certain whether Charlie or Leela will be here, but we can always move it again if necessary.
25th? Okay.
No, I'm just going to.
Not the agenda.
So, policies and procedures handbook, Mr. Melita, have there been any changes since last year?
There haven't. All the changes have to be ratified, approved by the commission. I think this is a placeholder, and we typically make sure we discuss it at the first organizational meeting each year to remind the commission that you are the stewards of the policy and procedures handbook, and if you think there are changes, this would also be the meeting where staff would bring to you anything that they, in anticipation of it being on the agenda today, that they have identified might need to be amended, but I think Bobby, you've done that, or you've had your staff do that, and have not determined that there's anything.
There's no policy or operational changes.
Okay. So there's no recommended changes, but it's always the commission could on its own accord request a change or consideration of change.
And we can do that at this meeting or any meeting throughout the year, right?
Correct. This is mostly a reminder.
Okay. Anybody have anything on the top of their heads?
I mean, I was just going to add, I think attending that CPC certification class in Richmond was an eye-opener for me. It would have been a huge benefit 2 years ago to really get a baseline. I almost feel like we should adopt that as a requirement or a high recommendation that commissioners go through that
right
and level set. So we're all prepared to do the job.
Sure.
It's just my, I'm going to make a suggestion for that.
Yeah, I, having gone through the program, I also, you know, I can't argue against that. And I went through the program after being on the commission for 6 years.
Yeah.
And felt like, wow, I could have been a better commissioner if I had been through this earlier. So four of us have been through it. Larry, do you have plans to go through the program?
Larry, do you?
Okay. So let's talk about that as a full commission when Leela and Charlie are here. So we'll just have that as a future agenda item under discussion.
Also, Major, Mr. Chair, that there's some old language in there referring to special exception, probably staff will probably bring forward eventually to clean up and then update the history of the department that's lapsed in 2012. So there's just other things that are just floating around in there, nothing, but again, no policy recommendations.
Okay. Great. Anyone else have anything else to say about that? Good suggestion. Scott, appreciate it. And again, anything policy related, you can bring it up throughout the year. Jump into our presentations. We are fortunate to have the Economic Development Director, Sean Washington, here today for the quarterly update. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me. Happy New Year, everybody.
Happy New Year. Is this the first meeting where it doesn't say acting in front of Economic Development Director?
That's correct, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate that. Thank you. I tell everybody my grace period is over. So. I'm sorry, Sherry, is there a clicker? Do I just do the hour for me? Okay, I got it. Thank you. So, Happy New Year. Afternoon, everybody. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Vice Chairwoman, and our commissioners for your time today. Always a pleasure to be before you. So I did have an opportunity to go back to my last presentation, which was September. So I was able to catch all the projects up to speed there and really want to do a little bit of deep dive into, as I like to say, all things mall, specifically, of course, Military Circle and MacArthur Moore towards the end, and then let you know what economic development is working on in the future here. Always start off with the team, and so there's been some significant updates, including myself, I should say, so my little color-coded system. But in green, you'll actually see positions that were vacant last time I was with you that are now filled. One of them I really want to highlight is Ms. Nikki Southall, who's a business development manager overseeing all things small business. Those who know Nikki, she worked in the neighborhoods department for quite some time. Nikki actually served on my evaluation committee for my grant program since I created it in 2017. So she knows what we do well. She just got her MBA from NSU, and so we're really happy to have her on board and fill that gap. We got some administrative assistants in Brittany Hatcher, also in the small business space. We hired Terry Scope. Terry actually used to work for Devaris. She was on the other side of property management for Military Circle Mall, so I brought her on board to help out in this space that we're diving in. And then yellow are vacant positions at this current time, but all these are posted. Applications have come on in. We're starting to do some interviews for some of these positions. I'm really excited about the office manager position because that would be my assistant, which I need at this moment. And we have a vacancy in our assistant director position, which I will be posting here shortly. So really, really great progress, but really looking forward to kind of filling the bench, if I can call it as such.
Sean, I can't read
that far, unfortunately.
Oh, I'm sorry. Can we get a copy of this presentation?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Sure, everybody has it.
Super.
Yep.
Thank you very much.
Absolutely.
Talked about this last time. Really excited about the strategic plan that we're leaning in. And so actually on Wednesday, we're having a really good mid-year review with our consultant. So we brought our consultant on back in October of 2022. We finalized this document about the middle of 23, and then we're at the halfway point. So we're looking at a couple of things. You may recall I did a deep dive about all of our strategies and our metrics and our goals. We want to make sure we're on task, for the end of the fiscal year, and also if we need to pivot and or course correct. One of the things we are doing intentionally is twofold. We're adding in more DEI focus. I saw that in a lot of our programs, specifically in Norfolk Works and the small business, we did a real good job, I think, with really leaning in on those variables, but we need to have some more attention behind some of our attraction and our major projects and business retention and expansion. And then we're also going to be focusing a lot on staff development. A lot of feedback from the employee surveys that we received, and a lot of the team is looking to do more professional developments, and we want to make sure we layer in those opportunities from there. And then lastly, just kind of internal staffing, if I can call it as such, I really want to drive attention to our website. And so the marketing team actually went through a refresh right before the end of the year. This is just one quick snapshot. There's a lot of analytics happening on the back end, and what the team analyzed were what were those frequent pages and or hyperlinks that were being clicked on our website. So we wanted to pull those to the front, and we also found out that those most visited areas, real estate development, incentives, for example, were buried on the website, so we just pulled them up to the front so we can have a better user experience. One of the things as it relates to our vision is all things about being a trusted partner, which relates to customer service, and so if people are having problems finding some of those high accessible resources that they're looking for, we want to make sure we brought them to the forefront. So we got that done right before the new year. One thing I also want to talk about from a strategy standpoint is what we're doing in the grant space. So we have an attraction team, a business intelligence team, and then we actually deployed a grant strategy. Really excited to talk about this because, and this really yields to all things Landports Points Dock, and of course our focus around offshore wind. You might have saw an announcement, this was in about November, that Economic Development Authority was awarded a $39 million grant. This actually was from the Department of Transportation, and more specifically the MARAD, which is the Maritime Administration Department there underneath DOT. All those dollars are being used for the infrastructure of Lambert's Point Dock. So actually you can imagine the manufacturing of these large components weigh tons, and so there need to be some additional dredging being done. There need to be some strengthening of the berth, because as these components are manufactured, they're actually going on barge and getting out to the water. And so this $39 million is going to be in place to do just that. There were two other programs that happened on the state level, which is a port host development grant, as well as a Virginia Business Ready Sites grant. And so those two grants were being used to help with the demolition, some of the removal, some of the old rail line and the tracks, in order to have a better kind of transportation and circular type of movement on the site itself. But all in terms of grants and these three buckets there is $43 million. And this is the way for us to defray some of the incentives that we know we're going to get asked for when it comes to doing developments of this size. We're able to say, well, hey, we don't have to go directly after general fund dollars, but here's some other areas that we can tap into that helps drive a development and bring underutilized real estate back into the tax rolls. And so a lot of administration is happening on the back end, but again, this strategy has really been working well for us. In the world of attraction, and so what happened in November really was a really good announcement for Huntington Ingalls or Newport News Shipbuilding. This was actually the first time that Huntington Ingalls has a flag on this side of the water. And this was a really, really big deal when I had the opportunity to speak to the CEO and some of the higher-ups about expanding their footprint. I'm going to talk a little bit later about what's called ASCUS, which is actually an initiative that's happening in the Indo region of the world to help out with the additional manufacturing of submarines. And as you can imagine, Huntington Ingalls is one of the key drivers and manufacturers for that product. And so they're busting at the seams in Newport News, so they're now starting to make their presence here in Norfolk. So again, $19 million in capital investment that they've done over at Lambert's Point Dock, and then they're going to be creating 150 new jobs over the course of, I believe, about 4 years. If I remember the numbers correctly, when we did this groundbreaking, it had about 20 employees already there. So a lot of good movement from that standpoint. Business retention and expansion, kind of the core of what we do. So a lot of folks are familiar with the old Ford plant here, but KTN, we had a really big announcement with them on last year for one of their big facilities. They actually announced another 60 million and 76 new jobs. So they did some additional expansion work in their other facilities, about 450,000 square feet of their rail house there. You really can't see it in this particular picture, but there is a rail line that's actually going towards the, I think it's the northern side of this particular site. And so one of the big things we were able to communicate was that we're trying to mitigate truck traffic from being on the road in between this particular community. And so we were able to help with a rail spur grant, which is completely free for the city. We just need to pass a resolution on the city level, and the state actually does the funding. And so their inventory now and raw materials are coming in through rail and not actually coming in, obviously, through the port and then via truck traffic here. So it really was a win-win for the city. And again, we were able to kind of usher that product through. So really the core business of everything that we do. And then last but not least, from the BRE standpoint, I think a couple folks are aware of this. Lion Shipyard, they had their big ribbon cutting here with the governor and, of course, the mayor. This was September, $8 million investment for them, 134 jobs. Their $8 million, you can see the big crane in the background there. They're really diving into more of offshore wind and vessel services in that particular space. So, again, they were able to get the $8 million investment, some additional funding on the state level, and then we're working with them as we normally do through Norfolk Works to help out with the job creation piece. So the activity that we do day-to-day is still happening, and it's exciting to see that, again, there's a lot of new investment and tax dollars coming to our city. In the spirit of Norfolk Works. One of the things that we were awarded was 2023 Higher Education Chancellor Award. And so this was actually outstanding achievement through collaboration. So all the work that we do with Drive Now and Well Now is with one of our core partners, which is TCC. And so TCC actually was the one that submitted on our behalf. We knew nothing about it, but we just found out about it there. This was in the beginning of December. And so Mike Paris, who stood up Norfolk Works back in 2017, was able to go to this particular event on our behalf. But again, a lot of work that's happening on the background with Norfolk Works, but it really is good to have some sort of recognition for what we do day to day. So just want to make sure I shared this with this group as well. Commercial corridors, small business. And so this has really been kind of the day-to-day of my business creation team. And so we have actually gotten through two rounds of grants already. If you remember last time, I talked a lot about the Riverview development as well as the 35th Street as our starting point. I would tell you in round one, we awarded 11 businesses. It was about $452,000 in grants in round one. And then for round two, you can see some of the numbers here. We had about 108 attendees at our workshops, 62 applications, 36 went to scoring, and 11 of those were actually awarded for round two. And so I can tell you that dollar amount was about $420,000, we're close to $900,000 in money out the door. We have one more round to go. That's actually why I had the website up here earlier. But the last round is actually going to be opening up on January 15th, and that round is going to be open for 30 days till February 16th. I will tell you that in our budget cycle, we did put in for another $1.2 million so we can continue this program. The initial funding came from ARPA dollars. It was $2 million altogether, and we will absolutely spend that money by June 30 of 2025. And then the last thing I will add regarding this work is that the actual businesses have a year to do the work. So just because we executed the contract, we've encumbered the dollars, they actually have a year to finish all the work. So we're going to be monitoring that and really looking at the before and after pictures. And that's a story we want to be able to tell as it relates to the success of this program here.
Will this round have a geographic focus, or will it be across the city?
Great question. So it's still geographic focus, high priority Riverview and 35th Street. One of the things I did not highlight, and so in the first round, if I remember correctly, out of the 11, there were two businesses that were not in those corridors. And then in the last round, I think there was only one business that wasn't in the corridor. The plan is, though, hopefully if we get refunded, that will be opened up to the whole city and not a particular focus. And that's why we wanted to kind of label this as a pilot program to get the kinks out. And I think we're there now. Yep. As I'm talking about Riverview, and so I mentioned this at one particular instance months ago where we actually submitted for a grant to help out with John Childress, who purchased the Riverview Theater through what's called the Department of Housing, Community Development, Industrial Revitalization Fund. Unfortunately, we were not awarded that grant, but we did submit another grant on his behalf, which was through the Port Host Grant. So the same grant that we had for Landmass Point Dock, we were able to figure out how can we leverage that grant for this particular facility. So we're kind of going back to the wheelhouse House to see if we can assist in some way, shape, or form. These are similar numbers that you know already in terms of the owner, the asset, 15,000 square feet. John wants to bring back theater and retail and a little bit of entertainment there also. So we submitted for this grant back in the end of November, November 29th to be exact, and we are requesting $1 million in advance. So we'll hopefully be able to hear back from that by the end of this month, but if not, by early February. But like I said, really, really our focus on leveraging grant dollars that we're seeing on the state and federal level to help mitigate dollars that are coming through the potential general fund. In the same light, we did this with this particular partnership here, and you guys may have saw on the news back in October, this project with the Urban League of Hampton Roads here called The Village. What you're looking at is 720 Church Street, which a lot of folks know as the former Save-A-Lot Shopping Center. And so the Urban League, as well as my department, we actually collaborated on a grant also through the Department of Housing and Community Development that goes up to about $3 million. They're trying to do several things. If you're kind of looking at it in the northern eastern side of this picture here. They want to obviously bring back the grocery store, number one priority that we hear for the St. Paul's residents. Family Dollar is already being rebuilt, but they're also looking to expand. And so there's also some workforce component here, a little additional retail, medical. In the upper left-hand corner, they have what's called their empowerment hub, which is actually a minority business hub. They have this concept in other areas within the United States, specifically in Omaha, Nebraska, and so they want to actually bring that concept here as well. What we submitted for was just for what we're calling phase one, which was, of course, the Family Dollar, because that's already happening, the grocery store, and then the workforce center. So same thing on the state level. Hopefully we'll hear from this come the end of January and or mid-February for this particular application. And then one that snuck up on us as an economic development team, I think many of you are familiar with the Lafayette River Annex here. And so the Navy actually sent out an RFI to try to get ideas of how do they look to potentially, and I really want to use that word, redevelop this particular site. They issued that back in October of 2023. And so we've been working with them to kind of get an idea of what's been the feedback from potential development sources. Is it residential? Is it office? We have no idea. But it is 20 acres on the water. There's 12 buildings on there altogether. Very historic 130 square foot building that's currently headquarters for NAFAC. And so, again, we're just monitoring this activity right now. I do know that the responses were due back in December 14th. And so even our partner, Lynn Ramirez, who's our military liaison, is being a point of contact for us to see if we can get some information and intel on if they're actually going to submit a formal RFP for proposals on this site. So really just wanted to make sure I put this on everybody's radar.
Is this
yep.
That's right there, yep. The
right
over
the bridge.
Yeah, like I said, it's not a whole lot of us as well.
But we were happy that we were aware of it. So like I said, we can kind of put our eyes on it and keep it monitored. Also for economic development, and then I'll get into mall world. So we are still working closely, even with our planning team, looking at all things, I like to call it Globe Iron. Actually, I was on a call with the Housing Authority a little earlier today, talking about their site at Moulton Circle. And I know this is a big priority for Councilwoman Johnson and, of course, the study that planning did with ADAPTA. So we know we're all going to be working in concert regarding this site. But I really think there's still some opportunity here for this to be a job generator, something that's not going to be a heavy tax on the community, so something in the tech or innovation space here, but most importantly, the collaboration between the departments as well as the Housing Authority is going to be important for the success of this particular development as we go forward. And then lastly, what's beginning to kind of pop back up on our end is I think all are aware of the Midtown study that happened back in April of 2022. Again, when you think about Commercial Corridor, Riverview, obviously the anchor of the zoo in the 35th Street, this is right along that particular boundary. So my team has been contacted by a couple of developers asking, hey, what's going on with Midtown? Can we have some conversation? So this is something else I'm going to talk to with, of course, Nathan Sims on the Housing Authority side. So he's aware of this particular study and all the work that the city has done. But I really do believe that we're going to continue to see some interest in this particular area. And so it may be economic development and or the Housing Authority with planning that kind of takes the lead going forward. So, with that being said, I wanted to make sure we did updates in terms of malls. So I did this presentation at the council retreat, and so some of you may have seen this already, but small updates even from that time in November. But I just wanted to emphasize, so three out of the four out parcels have already been demolished. What everybody knows as, of course, that former Chuck E. Cheese or the Suave Plaza, that actually should be down by the end of this month. I just saw the paperwork get cleared for that. So that would be the last out parcel along Military Circle that would be completely down. We've done a lot of work, though. Of course, we put up the permanent fencing, not just along the sites that have been demolished, but around, of course, the inner ring road of the mall. Ross has asked us to modify the signs. They wanted to make it clear that they were still open for business, and my wife was very happy about that because that's our favorite place. So we did that all along the ring road as well, just to make sure that we weren't being impeding on their business. Been a ton of environmental work and site plans that are happening, and then we already did get one of our consents of waiver with Sentara. One thing I mentioned last time I was here is that since it's an old operating agreement, if we're going to do anything in terms of demolition, Ross as well as Sentara and two other folks had to sign our consent of waiver. So we have the consent from everybody except for Ross. That's the last thing that we're waiting to do. And because of that, we cannot actually begin the demolition of the interior ring road. And so that's why this timeline exists as it is. So again, that final out parcel will be down by the end of the month. Hopefully, if we get the signature from Ross, we want to go ahead and release the RFP for the interior demolition of the ring road by February. A couple of months, of course. Hopefully, we can go ahead and bring on a demolition company. And then we've been told that demolition of the entire mall, this includes the old Cinemark, the old Macy's, Sears, the old Doubletree Hotel, is going to be anywhere from 12 to 14 months. And so part of that demolition RFP, we're asking the companies to tell us what is the best way to phase this thing as it relates to the requirements of Sentara being there and Ross still being there and operating. As it relates to the future, we're doing a little bit of, I like to call it a reset button for a moment. Obviously, we went through a long journey as it relates to RFQs and RFPs, which everybody is aware of, but that was 2021. And so we're in a new market space right now. And so we also know two big things aren't necessarily happening. There's not a big appetite from the city to put an arena here. And also, Sentara, normally and originally, was going to be the office anchor at anywhere from 400,000 to 600,000 square feet. That is just not happening in current times. So in my particular vision, I said that we need to go ahead and kind of reimagine what's going to be the real future of this site based on current times. We also want to revisit this whole health and wellness theme. This is how it started with Sentara. And so we started having a conversation with them saying, hey, look, we know you don't need all this office presence, but do you need any additional presence? You're already here based on our old JCPenney box. So before we go down this path, we want to make sure that we had a dialogue with you first before we went anywhere else. And then there's been a lot of conversation from other private sector interests just saying, hey, look, we know you've kind of stalled here a little bit, but we'd be willing to come down. We've done this development all around the country to be able to kind of analyze this for you and help you figure out what's going to be the future. One of the things that I heard loud and clear at the council retreat was that they wanted to make sure that this was being planned in concert with MacArthur, so we're not duplicating what were happening from one downtown mall to our other suburban mall. So very, very important for that particular feedback.
Sean, when you're doing that planning for Norfolk, certainly important, but you also look at what development's planned for Virginia Beach and Chesapeake, so that we're not all creating the same venue, if you would, that competes with each other.
Yeah, absolutely. The original theme was for it to be transformational. That's going to be something unique for us. So we still have that in mind. It's not going to be as vast as an arena at this particular point. But yes, doing those market studies of kind of competing interests, if I can call it as such, top priority. Yeah.
So have we taken such a step back, such a reset that went through a small area plan process would be appropriate, or is this something that economic development is just going to take on and work with development companies? It doesn't feel like something that should happen incrementally that would then undermine what the greater outcome could be. Sorry.
Yeah, Sean, sure. You know, we have the Military Circle plan already. That's a small area plan.
Yeah.
It talks about uses in form and other driving factors. Staff does not believe that there is a reason to pivot from that at this moment. There are other extenuating circumstances that may, depending on what the market reveals, but as far as the mix of uses and other things that have been proposed in there, I don't think there's anything that the staff
believes currently that this change. Yes.
So is economic development, and I use that not just as a department, but broadly, going to make a better effort to follow that plan more closely, or follow that plan at all, or
yes,
do you agree that it's a good plan?
Yes, so let me step back. When economic development issued the RFQ and the RFP, this goes all the way back to 2019, 2020, we were leveraging the plan in the first place.
Right.
Yes. And so even when we asked the three teams that we all know of to respond, we said, you need to make sure that you are proposing this development based on this plan. So that was always the case from day one. We pushed the envelope because we were the ones that said we wanted something transformational that was going to be not just Norfolk-centric, but something that was going to drive almost from a tourism standpoint from outside of our city and even arguably outside of the region. Yep. MacArthur, and so a whole different discussion, but we have, in my opinion, a firmer timeline on this. So this actually goes back to the fall of last year. We actually bought on Gensler. Gensler is one of the world's largest architectural firms. They've done mall redevelopments literally all around the world. We have worked with them before here in the city of Norfolk, so we bought them on to kind of do an initial analysis for us. They came into the market, and as everybody is, highly impressed with the city. They've actually never seen, again, a mall sitting in the middle of the downtown with so much walkability and all the other assets that we all know of, cruise terminals, Scope, Arena, Chrysler, so on and so forth. And so based on some of their initial stakeholder conversations, because they definitely had a good amount of them, this was their charge that they've heard for some of those dialogues there about acting urgently, we're going to be bold, we want to make sure we're assessing adaptability. There's a lot of great components about the mall that we know that we could absolutely preserve, but we also have to make sure that we're looking at development of the future for the next 30 to 40 years. And so some of the items on the right were some of the additional comments that they had. We want to make sure that we're promoting play, attract tourists here, celebrate our culture, ignite innovation, just to name a few. And one of my favorites is kind of build community. I've reminded everybody that it's not just a central business district anymore. It is a neighborhood downtown just based on the residential count. So we have to take all that into consideration. One thing I really want to mention that we did and we emphasize here is that it's not just about coming up with a conceptual drawing. It was really about doing the market feasibility and economic analysis, and that was a huge part of their work before they started to sketch out anything. And so they looked at everything, even in terms of hotel vacancies here. Is there a product or type that we're missing? They wanted to know, can we absorb another hotel in this particular mix of downtown? Because the footprint has plenty of room to actually bring that back as a potential redevelopment stake. They also looked at all the other asset classes that we have down here. Obviously, the office, what you see in the red is that based on the numbers that we're a little bit overly prescribed to office right now, and there's still a lot of course, down on where the office market is going. We did know that we can thoroughly support this 200,000 square feet of retail, and this is removing what's already there, but bringing back retail that more supports the neighborhood component side of downtown right now. We all know that there are aspects downtown that are missing, and so they think that could be about 200,000 square feet all in. Hotels, like I said, there was a little bit of back and forth between could we absorb another product here or not. And then even multifamily, as we see buildings coming up downtown, there's still some room to really absorb more of the residential headcounts that we're seeing here in the terms of 200 units. So this was a brief summary that they submitted here. What they thought, based on a current market here, was new boutique or limited service hotel. So it doesn't need to be something in terms of 400 or 500 beds, maybe something around 100 beds, for an example. 1 to 2 medium-sized multifamily, as we said, we absorbed that. Some new ground floor retail that's focused on food and bev, community grocery store, just to name some of the few. Big conversation about this activated urban park. A lot of the developments I've seen, they've tore down the inline, and right in the middle of their developments, they're making that urban park. If you kind of think about a central park, but only maybe 2 or 3 acres, and then some sort of shared convenience space that might support some of the technology or office space as it relates to the Norfolk Innovation Corridor, one of the stakeholder conversations they had. However, if we want to push the envelope a little bit, you could look at what they came up here on the right-hand side here. And so a lot of conversation about convention center and conference center space, right? And I know, of course, we have those challenges, I'll say, that are happening in Virginia Beach. Beach and or in Hampton. But again, we have a different story and a different mix here. And so we've talked to the hoteliers to say there could be a space for a convention center, but you got to have the right operator there to be able to bring in those state and also federal associations that's going to help keep that asset full. Entertainment came up as well, even potentially a small box theater. If you do a convention center, now you got to have a headquarters hotel. That was the difference between what happened in Virginia Beach. And surprisingly enough, a lot of conversation with the Navy and NATO, they actually have a desire to kind of get off of their particular premise and have more frontage, I'll call it, in downtown. And so having some permanent space from them actually came up as a potential recommendation also. I promise I'm almost done. So this is a little bit of a programming, and again, you'll have this electronically here, or what they say can fit, because we're looking at about a million square feet altogether. And the big message here is to say you can actually have it all, right? You can do a convention center, you can do more of a cultural asset, entertainment, retail, hospitality, office, all those things can fit right here on this site. And guess what? We don't have to tear down our parking garages, because obviously nobody wants to do that. And so the next phase of the work that Gensler is actually doing for us is that we are doing a deep dive into a convention center study. We want to make sure that we check that particular box before they sketched out what the concepts can be. And so what we're anticipating receiving back by the end of February is a plan A. There's a plan that actually has a potential convention center in there, and what does the rest of the use of the site look like? And or B, if we don't actually have the market for it, then there would be no convention center, but they will program the rest of the site. So it would be a highest and best use based on the full analysis and everything that they've done for us already. Really great visual that I like to show here, because it really kind of blocks out, if you're a Lego fan, again, all the different uses and the potential square footage of some of those uses here as well. Even as far as this Atlantic Center Museum, again, just putting some sort of name on NATO having some sort of physical presence here, or even conversation with the Navy Museum that we already have in Nauticus. And so I think the most important thing to say here about MacArthur is that the possibilities really are endless. But Gensler has the proper charge right now. They're looking at both of those cases for us. We want to make sure that we're not presenting in front of the community something that's unrealistic to be able to develop. And that's why we want to make sure they spent that time doing the market study and the feasibility study as well. Last but not least for me, then of course I'll always take questions. We're continuing our internal collaboration with planning and my particular team here. We were together on last week, and so big ask that they had for my team was to continue to do some research on what are the future uses that are happening in the market. Do we need to talk about any type of zoning amendments or new zoning in some of our business parks, just to make sure that we're continuing to be business friendly and drive that tax revenue? And then my team, as well as DHCD and DEI, we're going to begin to have our bi-monthly meetings as well. A lot of overlap in some of the work that we're doing here, specifically in some of the areas of economic inclusion. And so we want to make sure that we're all being consistent in some of our practices. Going forward for us, big conversation on retail focus and strategy. One of the things we're talking about is we understand that the mall has a 54% vacancy right now. So if businesses are exiting, what are we doing to keep them in Norfolk, right? So we're doing a better inventory on what's actually vacant, not just on Grammy Street, but around our whole city. And we're going to start to have some dialogue with some of these tenants now as it relates to, hey, as leases start to expire, we want to keep you in the city. Here's somewhere that you can look at. Partnership with the Alliance, they're still doing their work with Clean Energy Initiative, and I mentioned this a little earlier, OSCLUS. So that's that trilateral partnership between Australia, UK, and the US. And again, it's their efforts to make sure that specifically Australia has a good presence of submarines in that Indo-Pacific region. We know that the manufacturing is going to happen at Huntington Ingalls, and so we're trying to figure out, would they be looking to use any of the footprint in Norfolk to help with that particular mission and those efforts. So more to come there. And then last but not least, really excited about this Area Development Spring Consultants Conference. And so these are the folks we talk to say, hey, your clients are looking to expand all over the world. Come to Hampton Roads, specifically come to Norfolk. And this is the first time that this particular forum has happened in Hampton Roads. It's going to be in Virginia Beach, but all the cities are having a great presence just to make sure that we're driving more business to our cities. And I think I went over my normal 15 minutes, so I apologize there, but I'm happy to take any questions.
Not should be on Planning Commission. I think we're all very interested. Questions, commissioners?
Yeah.
Sean, you referenced the Midtown plan. Any movement with the Ward's Corner plan? I know that was pretty comprehensive, and
That's funny you said that too. So I wouldn't necessarily label this as movement. What I will say is that I've been having a lot of dialogue with, it's called Slate Asset Management. So they actually own what we know as a former Farm Fresh across the street there. And so they had a long-term lease with Kroger's on that particular site, and that lease actually expired at the end of December. And so I put a feeler out to them on yesterday to say Happy New Year. Would like to sit down and talk to see what the potential is on that particular site there. So we're absolutely looking at that. And then I know there's still some dialogue across the street there with Coterides and their large retail applicant as well. So
next to the future Coterides project,
yeah,
is that also part of the plan, or is that part of city?
Are you referring to so they had the whole site there. So I call it the former Human Services building there. And then, yes, so all that, and the building next to it, yes, that's all a part of that development. Yes, correct. Yeah.
I just want to personally thank you also for your engagement and support for the local businesses. I've heard from several of them recently that you've been very accommodating and listening and hearing some of the challenges that they're experiencing. And I think that's the engine that, you know, slowly drives the tax revenue for the city. So thank you for giving that some priority in addition to the large, you know, projects that are coming through.
Absolutely.
So thank you for that.
Never a dull moment.
That was a good one noticed. Commissioners, any other questions? I appreciate all that is being considered for MacArthur Center.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe it can be a mix of many things, but it can't be everything. And it's going to be about making that big decision as to what the priority should be. And I really think the community aspect of that should be the number one priority.
Mm-hmm.
I find that cities that invest in the citizens who are already there in itself attracts citizens from outside of the area. And convention centers don't do that. Convention centers are building toward the past, not the future. And does nothing for the downtown folks. So I would de-emphasize that if it was me.
Yeah.
And I know that there are bigger things at play. And also when considering the entertainment venues,
mm-hmm.
don't just look at the city venues. You've got the Norva across the street that brings more than 300,000 people downtown every year, which is more than any one of those facilities. And I would hate for them in the world's largest entertainment company to be turned off by the city building a competing facility again right across the street.
Yeah,
spot on. Anyway, just a couple of initial comments.
Yep. And I would add in Wells Theater as well in terms of that conversation,
yes.
The proximity. Yeah, you're absolutely correct.
Great. Again, thank you very much. Sure. Appreciate you
continuing
thank
to visit with
it.
Us.
that's not what we're supposed to be looking at right now, but thank you very much. I'm excited to be here, update you on this project. I think it just really kind of filters in the background mainly. I'm going to start with giving you a little bit of an update just because not some people are new, but we started an architectural building resurvey citywide back in 2020. It hadn't been updated in over 20 years. And so the format now is you create a plan. So we do have a link to it on our website. I'm going to tell you a little bit more about it later. But this is kind of our guiding document for resurveying the city. The first year, we did a resurvey of North Berkeley State National Historic District. And we have a phase one of a resurvey of West Freemason, which is State National and Local Historic District. In 2022-23, we did a survey of Campostella Heights and phase two of West Freemason. Campostella Heights is not designated as anything at this time, and we're going to go over the survey information for these later. And then looking forward this year, we are currently at the beginning of surveying Lindenwood Phase 1 and Anna Street. I will say the surveys that we've been dealing with initially in this batch have to do with requests from neighborhoods where people have been really interested in having their history of their neighborhood outlined. In our survey plan. We identified threats, themes, and priorities, and those are really what kind of guide us in trying to go out and get the grant money to pay for these surveys. Overview of our presentation, or my presentation today, is the Campus Stella Heights survey, West Freemason Phase 2, and then where we're going with Lindenwood and Anna Street. So in Campus Stella Heights, this was, we did a preliminary building information on every building in the neighborhood and a history of how the neighborhood was developed in up until now. And so I just want to let you know that it's costly to do these types of surveys. Total cost for Campus Stella was $60,760, and you see the city portion versus the state portion. This is actually a 50-50 grant. When you see more with the state, they had generously offered us their leftover funding that they did not encumber through other applications for 2 years, which has allowed us to do more work, so we're very thankful about that. But so I want to say that Campus Stella Heights is in South Norfolk, bordered by the Elizabeth River to the north, Steamboat Creek to the east, East Indian River Road to the south, and Campus Stella Road to the west. The neighborhood primarily consists of single-family dwellings with three churches. There are a handful of non-contributing commercial buildings along the perimeter of the district, which are not incorporated into the boundary. There are a total of 271 primary resources, and 243 of these are considered contributing to this potential district. So what you're looking at is the map on the right, where it has shaded buildings versus outlined buildings. So the shaded buildings are what they consider contributing to the history and development of the district. So as you can see, the architectural styles in Campus Stella are typical in Norfolk, neighborhoods of the same periods. Dwellings are mixed of one and two-story buildings, have a variety of basic building forms. A variety of styles are wide-ranging, contain most of the early to mid-20th century styles, like Colonial Revival, Dutch Revival, Folk Victorian, Queen Anne, Shingle Craftsman, Tudor, Minimal, Traditional, and Ranch. There are also three churches in this district that are also contributing. You're probably familiar with these. I just put them in to show you the variety of styles. And then, so the survey said, bore out that the period of significance for the district is 1903 to 1973. So how do they determine that? So it's generally when the area was first developed up into about 50 years back from now. So if you take 2023 from 1973, that's 50 years. And then survey finding also said overall the neighborhood retained strong integrity in the area of location, design, setting, feeling, and association, and has good integrity in regards to workmanship and materials. So if you're familiar with this neighborhood, you know it's very intact. It's a lovely neighborhood, well kept. If you haven't been through there, you should do it. You know, take a drive through there. And the state sets out criteria for which makes these districts very significant, and in this case, criterion A on for civil rights due to the housing discrimination that went on early in this development, the planning, community and planning. So this is a good example. So I want to let you know something that we did differently with this survey, which we're very excited about. So if you go to our web page, we actually have a web page, Survey NFK. So this is just a snapshot of the Campus Stella information on the page. So the history form is something you can click on and get the history of the neighborhood, the location map and sketch map I showed you on another slide. But the historic building survey draft, this is interesting because what we've done is we've literally put every address on our website so people can residents or former people who may have lived in these homes can see what identifying information pertaining to the historic property we captured. And so if you click on our example is 1900 Montclair, which it's just magically going to come up here in a minute, is the VCRIS card. So it's the Virginia Cultural Resource Information System. Since they've helped fund this, we have this is the information they captured. This is kept at the state. There's three pages of description, site information, age of the property, if there's any accessory buildings, if you scroll down. So then we get into some, keep scrolling. The photo images, this house happens to be on a corner, so you get a couple of, you know, generally 3 to 4 sides of the house. There's another photo. And then the final photo also captures the accessory, the garage, which is a later build, but part of the property and actually still a contributing structure because of the age. And then you go down one more, and this is interesting because it gives you a lot of site information and tells you what's there. It gives you a snapshot of what was there at the time of the survey. So if you could take me back to the PowerPoint, next slide. So this was really exciting. We got this in October. They submit the survey findings to the State Review Board and the Department of Historic Resources at their September 21st meeting recommended Camp Estella Heights as eligible for nomination to the National Register of Historic Places and the Virginia Landmarks Register. So we have made several attempts to get with the Civic League and see if they're interested in going to the next step. More work has to be done. But we were excited to receive this. I was told before I got here that over 11 years ago that there was an interest by the residents to have it designated, and the state felt that it didn't have enough significance, maybe in part because the period of significance was narrower. But now they feel strongly that this is a good candidate for if the residents should want it. So that's a different discussion with them. But
congratulations, getting to this one.
Yeah, we were very excited. So, and so then from there we're going to go on to West Freemason, a little different story. So this is a state, national, and local district. For those of you who were on our pre-survey discussion presentation, the reason I choose this photo at the top is I think I shared with people were surprised to find out that building was literally too new at the time of the last survey in 1972 to be considered contributing to the district, and I think anybody in Norfolk would consider that an important building. And then, you know, we've expanded it to include the mid-century. But and we're also reevaluating the boundary in this district. And believe it or not, we had to actually update the last 100 years. This is a 400-year-old district in the city. It's very unique. It's got great architectural styles from actually every era, which is pretty exciting, and high style. It's a very interesting district. Or from a historic preservation point, it's as interesting district. So one of the discussions that we had with ARB on Monday, and we Faith and I will be out with the Civic League to show them some of the work we've been doing out here and talk to them about this. But where the green boxes are, due to the period of significance being updated from 1790 to 1972 and the inclusion of the mid-century style, we feel there's some buildings that should be looked at to be included in the local boundary. Now, I think most people think that a couple of these buildings are already in the district, but they're not. So those include 230 West Butte, which is where Cavalier Land is, 227 West York, and 223 West York. So one's an old antique store, and I believe one was an old photography store. And then, although Southern Bank would not be within the period of significance, it does fall more into the West Freemason District than the downtown, and it is not that far from being considered eligible. The design is very nice for the period of the building. Of course, most people think that 209 and 211 West Freemason are actually in the district now, and they're not. And then, of course, the boat club now is eligible. So we're going to look at that and talk to the residents about that and get more information. And then this is another thing that we've really been working on. Faith and I have, this is a Second Empire-style building, and Faith and I have worked on, we are not able to, even though we get good information on the VCRIS cards, it's not so helpful when you're reviewing buildings on the local level. And so we've created our own VCRIS card, or our own Norfolk card, if you will, which gives information that we use every day and what residents ask us about. And then we added another level to be able to put in information that relates to if people are interested in pursuing a Part 1 tax credit application, all the information they would need to fill it out themselves is in this form, which we are adding another field on air under the planning box. It hasn't rolled out yet. That should be coming shortly. I want to thank Matt Straley and his work for doing that. We have extensive architectural descriptions that Faith and I are developing. We have source information. We have our chairperson is an academic. He always wants to know who the architect was. Really hard to find out in a building that's of this age. We spent half a week scanning, thinking. I'd like to thank the assessor's office for allowing us to do it. The library, if you know Troy over in the Sargent Memorial Collection, they literally loaned us a high resolution scanner, so we scan these old assessor cards. We're probably in the city, we have the oldest, best collection is not available really for the general public. So we get requested these photos quite frequently. So this is a sample of one of them. We are gonna do these for all the updated locally designated historic districts. And so we are gonna share this with Freemason when we go out next week. And so we're very excited about this. And here's just a nice old photo of looking down the 200 block of West Freemason. So the next two areas that we're in the process of surveying, Lindenwood, phase one, and then Anna Street. In both cases, we were contacted by residents in these areas that are very interested in having their neighborhoods reviewed. So we've been working with them. We have a local consultant doing Lindenwood. As you can see, just a phase one is almost $41,000. So this is the phase one is the area outlined in red. And then even a resident sent this along. This was in the Ledger and Dispatch afternoon edition, if you keep your old newspapers. You could get a list here. They even listed out who your potential neighbors could be. And, you know, why rent when you can own? So referring back to our plan, both Anna Street and Lindenwood have preliminarily we've discovered really good basis there for capturing survey work for underrepresented groups, mid-century architecture, civil rights and sea level rise threats. So here's a sampling of some building styles within the phase one area of Lindenwood. And for those of you who aren't familiar with where Anna Street is, it's actually off Virginia Beach Boulevard, but you have to you can't get to it just directly off Virginia Beach Boulevard. You have to turn at a light. And then this is just like a service road that gets you down to this cute little peninsula neighborhood. And we are doing this entire area. We got a cost share grant on this one, and we're using a Richmond-based consultant who did L&J Garden Survey in Virginia Beach, which is a similar mid-century neighborhood. Here we have the Princess was their model home. It's still there. We did put in the assessor's card, which we scanned earlier today. Again, it's pretty much looks the same. Even the telephone pole is still there. It just got moved. And these are some of the homes in Anna Street. This is, and I should say, Lindenwood and Anna Street, really interesting. They're both, they were both developed for middle to upper middle class African Americans in different time periods. We're kind of curious whether or not some Lindenwood folk decided to build over in Anna Street and that kind of thing. We don't know how much of that we're going to find out. But they have some really nice style, mid-century architecture. We're getting really good feedback. We sent out a save the date card before Christmas for our meeting with the neighborhood. Please, if you want to join us, it's at the Jordan Newby Inker Library on January 25th in the Cloud conference room, not in the big conference room. So we would be happy to have you join us if you're interested. And then if you have any questions about survey, certainly you can ask Faith and I, but we are feeling very good about what we're accomplishing, although we would like to be moving faster. So of course, you know, I have to put out a plug that we would like to be funded a little better, but who wouldn't, right? So anyway,
thank you for all your work and your presentation. Did any of the commissioners have questions? So what determines which neighborhoods in which you conduct surveys? Does it have to be the neighborhood asking? Is it a requirement to certify local government? Is it the age of the neighborhood?
No, and that's a really good question. So we did a survey plan, and we did public engagement with a citywide survey. This was during COVID. And so what we don't have really good data on is our neighborhoods that weren't even considered under the last survey, so anything like 1930s, 40s, and newer. And so we had strategically planned to go around the city from the south side up around the east side and come all the way around and then come down downtown. Downtown's had more recent studies and so forth. But we prioritize neighborhoods that are interested in being surveyed. So we had had several requests prior to doing the plan. And so right now we're kind of topped out at our requested neighborhoods. I will say this, we do have a request from West Kent is interested in being state and nationally nominated. However, I will say that area doesn't meet any funding priority. I can't get a grant for that area. The city would have to commit to money for that area. These neighborhoods that we've been fortunate enough that are interested in it do meet funding priorities, so they're easier to get grant money for. But so we really have to strategize. It's really important to have an updated survey of our historic buildings because we're also engaging in, this ties very closely to federal funds used for the flood wall, Section 106, which is a requirement if $1 of federal funding goes into a project, you have to know what your historic, what they call resources, buildings, archaeology is around it. So we really have to move a little bit faster than we're going because we know the wall is moving faster. So, and I will say this, that the first leg of the downtown wall, the Army Corps is already engaging in Section 106 and doing some of that historic survey work there. But I've talked to them. I'd like to coordinate with them. I don't want to double dip on work, but I haven't really gotten a firm commitment from them. So So it has right now more to do with who's interested and how we, if we can get it funded. I would like to think that, you know, that we really, what we really need to do is look for money to do a whole citywide survey and then use grant money to do more intensive survey work for the people who are interested. Say Campus Stella says, yeah, we'd like to go state and national. Then we could then apply for the grant to finish that work. So we're not really going about it. We're doing the best that we can.
I love the additional information in the presentation that you're making available to the public. As someone who has searched multiple sources for information before, it's nice to see it all in one place.
Yeah, thank you. We're excited. We think people are going to really, it's going to resonate with them. We really hope people will feel more confident about doing their own historic tax credit forms, which is doable with the right information.
Great. Anything else? Again, thanks very much. Faith, thank you.
Mr. Chair, just to add to the work that Susan's doing, again, her and Faith have done a very good job. Part of what has made it possible to continue to move forward, as Susan said, with the grants, is the fact about, maybe it was four or five years ago, the underrepresented communities had opened up to allow for us to make sure to capture the history of those communities, and Virginia had put a significant amount of money into trying to make sure we capture that information. And so I think it's good for us to make sure that we don't lose any of that old history of people understanding what their neighborhoods were and how they got to where they are. And I think it tells the story of the city. And so the work is greatly appreciated. It's funny, we get an email from Susan McBride and Faith saying clear out the drive because we're taking a bunch of pictures. We got to empty out all the files because they're doing some significant work. And so for Susan's point, we are requesting additional funds to try to do more survey work, so not just the one-offs. So.
Thanks again. Okay, next on our agenda is the public hearing preview for our next public hearing.
Okay, good afternoon. Okay, so this item, as you recall, was... Should I wait for Kevin? Oh, wait. Was continued from your last public hearing. It is the Kingston, located at 1700 Kingston Avenue. It is on the north side of Kingston Avenue between Beaumont and Grove Avenue. I really dove in pretty deeply and gave a lot of detail, so I want to try to simplify it for today at least. So 1965, this site was developed as an 8-unit apartment building. It has been vacant. The apartment building has been vacant since at least 2010. Under both the 1992 zoning ordinance and the 2018, the current zoning ordinance, only a single family or a duplex would be permitted to be developed on this site, or that would be the only use it could be used for. Had the use continued, had that building continued to be used for an 8-unit apartment building, we wouldn't be here today. They could continue to use it. But because it wasn't used, it lost its vested status under the pre-92 zoning ordinance. So now they have to comply. And again, right now they can only do one or two. To do anything else, they have to come in. And in this instance, and I'm going to skip through a couple of these slides. The new owner is proposing to reestablish the use of the building as a multifamily structure with 5 apartments. So, in the current RC zoning district, it allows developments to waive certain standards. This particular site, we would, you know, there's a certain type of multifamily allowed in the RC. This would come under the mansion-style apartments. And in order to allow this site to be developed with the 5 units, they would have to waive certain development standards. All right, so I'm going to flip through the pictures here. Again, this is the site looking from Kingston. Below that, as we mentioned, there is an alley that runs from Kingston all the way to Ocean View. That's kind of what the graphic on the left represents. And then the graphic on the right, if you pull through the site and kind of beyond the building, you see a little structure there that it's also part of the building. going further. We're almost at Ocean View now. You can see it's pretty tight, and people do park. People who are houses front on that little alley do park in that alley. And then the final picture on the right is pretty much looking at Ocean View. This is the site plan that the applicant is proposing. So he's reconfiguring the parking to pull out into the alley, both in front of the building and then behind the building as well. At the public hearing, we had gone over what we had, which was, again, total of 5 units, but they were leaving 3 of the units for office and maintenance. We saw this at the public hearing. I did finally receive this from the applicant yesterday. And what he's saying is it's still 5 units, but on the first floor there would be 2 one-bedroom apartments and 1 two-bedroom apartments. That says 1 one-bedroom, but it's 1 two-bedroom. And then on the second floor there would be 2 two-bedroom apartments. So that's really what is being proposed now. And I'm going to skip that. So I mentioned that they are allowed under the RC district under the current zoning ordinance to request certain waivers. So there's a host of waivers he is requesting under the CUP. So the minimum lot width, the minimum number of stories, dwelling unit access from a common area, and then a host of parking standards that he would have to ask a waiver for. The other issue with this site, and it's kind of the elephant in the room, it is located in an accident potential zone. So this request anywhere else might be fine, but this is in an accident potential zone. And we worked long and hard with the military, with the Navy, on the joint land use program. And their take is that if it's allowed under the current zoning, we're okay with it. If you want to do anything more intense or more, we're probably not going to favor it in that accident potential zone. So that's the big issue that we have with this site. Anywhere else, it might be fabulous, but it is in an APZ2. And under current zoning, they're allowed to have a 1 or 2 family, and that's it. So again, we have received a letter of opposition from the commanding officer of the Norfolk Naval Station, because it's their thought that, again, the only thing allowed under current zoning would be a 1 or 2, not a 5. This has lost its vested status a long time ago. They shouldn't get what they have lost. Okay. Any questions on that one?
Susan, the other renderings and other photos and so forth, those are going to be part of the package for next meeting, or?
The?
What they shared with us in print during the last meeting, you have
this
all.
This is the only thing the applicant sent me. I can ask them to send me anything else they sent me during the meeting, but that's the only thing he sent me.
Will their communications go through the Navy since there's no letter? I wonder what the applicant is currently doing, because I'm hearing that there's innovations happening there. Do we know they're just kind of sticking to the current plan at the moment?
I will find out. I don't know.
There's 2 properties here. They'll get 2 separate conditional use permits is what they're looking for. They're requesting CUPs that are renewals so that they can continue to operate their short-term rental vacation rentals in these 2 adjacent 8-unit multifamily buildings located on the south side of East Ocean View Avenue between Beachview Street and Sturgis Street and Cottage Line. It does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030. It is in the Coastal Character District and designated as residential mixed. Property is zoned RC. Any short-term rentals with 3 or more units on a parcel are required to have a CUP to operate. So here we see the sites for the existing short-term rentals. On the right, 1353 was built in 1965. 1357 was built in 1966. Both were previously issued CUPs to operate short-term rentals, first in 2019, and it was renewed in 2022. Those current CUPs expire February 8th. Both buildings are now required to install sprinklers and obtain new certificates of occupancy. They will also be extending those front landscaping beds. As of today, neither property has any complaints on record. In the last 2 years, there have been a few calls for service to the police, but staff has determined only one directly related to a guest. The applicant has indicated the property will be self-managed. She does live on-site in one of the units and actively manages these units full-time. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 500 feet, approximately 70% of residential parcels are single-family. Approximately 20% of residential units are single-family. All-inclusive, if this application is approved, 4% of the residential parcels and 5.8% of residential units in 500 feet would be short-term rentals. As an additional note, Cottage Lion Civic League did indicate that they met with the applicant and voted to unanimously support these applications. And then based on the cost involved with those sprinkler installations, this will likely be a 10-year CUP that we're looking at.
Remind me why we continued this
one. This one was continued just because they had not had their site plan and sprinkler plan worked on ahead of time.
Weigh in on applications like this to begin from?
This one I don't believe is in a in any of those Navy zones that they would be concerned about. It's not in an APZ or anything like that.
Okay. Be surprised it's right down the street from the other.
Yeah, no, it's, the APZ I think ends a short way away from this one, but this one's not in an APZ.
It is located in one of those zones. As with our joint names,
okay. So they'll get it, whether it's existing use or okay. That was my question. Thank you.
I have a question. You said there was one call for service.
Yes.
Could you tell us what that is?
Sure. Back in August 2023, there was a guest that called 911 and reported that her companion had taken some drugs and was causing a disturbance. The police came, they did make an arrest and transported him to the hospital. The applicant actually approached the guest and ended her stay and had her leave the premises.
Mm-hmm. Pretty good.
All right, thanks. So here to talk to you about a proposed text amendment to our billboard regulations. Technically, the term is outdoor advertising sign, not billboard, but we're going to use the word billboard a lot, so just go ahead and put that on there, out there. So our current regulations permit essentially three different things with billboards. All require a conditional use permit. There are some caveats that I'll go through, but there are three allowances right now. The installation of a new sign requires a CUP, pretty much anywhere you do it, or anywhere you do it. Upgrade of an existing sign to a digital face with a larger sign face or a greater height within the limits established by the ordinance can be done if you have the CUP. There is a exception in the ordinance to do so on a sign facing select interstates that you don't have to get a CUP for that. So going to digital on one that is on city property or real land in the city, not VDOT property, facing Interstate 64, for example, that can be done without a CUP. But anywhere else requires it. And third, replacement of an existing sign with a new fully conforming sign. So taking one that is on a piece of property, taking it down and putting it up. A new one, if you become fully conforming, that's allowed. You need a CUP for that. It's essentially a restatement of the first one, but we're just being really, really clear on what you can and can't do. An item on your agenda later today brought to our attention another case that we do need to look at, examine. So that leads to our proposed amendments. We want to propose to add a fourth activity. Again, that would require a conditional use permit, but that would allow for the replacement of an existing ground-mounted non-conforming sign. So could be non-conforming for being too large, too close to a property line, any number of reasons, with a new one on the same lot, allowed. That is not currently allowed right now unless you want to become fully conforming. We know there are not every, there are not in every case can you become fully conforming, particularly with oddly shaped lots and setbacks. That becomes the bigger challenge. It's almost always possible to shrink the size of the sign, lower the height of the sign, but a lot of those placement requirements become a challenge. We don't want to let this happen without any limits. One limit, new sign can become no more non-conforming than the existing. So you can't make the sign bigger while you're doing this. The existing sign must be removed before the completion of the new sign. It feels odd that we have to say that, but we have to say that. Just because I work in zoning and I know what happens if we don't say that. And then one thing we don't want to give them leeway on is foundation landscaping. The foundation landscaping requirement of the ordinance, you should be able to meet that. You have a base of the sign, it's ground mounted, plant it. If it can't be, even if it has to be closer to the street or a little bit bigger than it otherwise would be allowed, you can plant the base of it. So we want to be clear that you have to still do that. Another element of what we're tweaking here, it plays along with the same thing, but it's actually a different section of the code. Right now we say no two signs can be within 500 feet of each other. We want to make sure that is, you're allowed to violate that piece of code with the same CUP in these cases only. I think I explained that correctly. So that's what we're proposing. There's a couple of little minor tweaks, language, just things that needed to be corrected, but we're essentially adding this fourth opportunity where there are currently three opportunities to install a sign with a CUP.
Permit replacement sign to violate the 500 minimum district requirement.
I wouldn't say that way. Can I take a crack at it?
Please do.
I think right now our code says you can't have signs within 500 feet of each
right.
other. And the proposed amendment would say you can have one of these signs only, an existing ground-mounted non-conforming sign that's getting moved on the same lot. You can do that within 500 feet of another sign. It already exists within 500 feet of another sign. So you can do that if the CUP says you can do it. So it's going through the same case-by-case analysis as the original question, should you be able to move it? If it's not appropriate, you won't get the CUP. And if it's no worse, as Jeremy said, no less conforming, no bigger, no taller, no closer to the street, still within 500 feet of the sign it was before, that the council could expressly allow that to happen in the CUP. It's an accommodation. It's making the accommodation possible through the CUP process, whereas right now it's not possible.
Does that apply to item 3 on our regular agenda? Okay.
Yes, I believe it does.
It does.
Yes.
That sign is already within 500 feet. And forming a ground mount.
And so if we didn't make this change, then the new scenario that we're talking about, you wouldn't be able to correct that nonconformity. So that's what this change is about, being able having the option to correct that nonconformity.
Right. I think no portion of that existing zoning lot is more than 500 feet from the other side. And so
the only way to correct it would be with a CUP. And it's not an option now.
I know this opens up, if we don't look at the other application, this opens up the possibility of just non-conformance passing on and non-conformance. And is that really what we want to open the door for here?
We tried to craft this as narrowly as possible so that we are applying to situations where you're going to improve the situation. Somewhat. At least you have the opportunity to improve the situation somewhat. But not requiring you to go full in on improving the situation. And that's something that we typically allow in zoning, is for you to come partway. But signs are, billboards especially, are unique because to move it, to make it better, you basically have to take it down. And once you've taken it down, by code, you got to put it back in forming. So it's an opportunity to get us partway that doesn't exist today to make things somewhat better. I don't, you know, in a lot of cases, there is no opportunity to make it fully better because of the dimensions.
500 feet measured from the sign itself or from the lot?
Should be sign to sign. No. I'm going to look at the code here real quick. No outdoor advertising sign shall be less than 500 feet from any other outdoor advertising sign. So it's sign to sign.
Okay, because I could see signs moving in and out of that 500 distance, foot distance, depending on the lot size. Okay, I just, the laws of unintended consequences here. Commissioners, give this some thought before the public hearing, and staff, please feel free to bring any concerns to our attention between meetings if necessary.
Absolutely.
Let us process this a little bit and come back to you with questions.
We've been doing the same.
I appreciate it.
I'll put a fine point, Mr. Chair, if that's okay.
Yeah.
What Jeremy said. The option now would be leave a sign the way it is, which could be potentially impacting.
That's it.
There's no opportunity to
right.
to manipulate, shift, or improve a situation, which is a typical thing that we do allow in some part in the zoning ordinance for other nonconformities. So it's so that I'll just say that there's an opportunity to improve something or it just says stay the way you are.
This is not too different of a discussion as we're having on the Kingston. You could have a zoning ordinance that's so rigid as to say, if you have an existing apartment building and it's not conformity, it has to be a single-family home, and you may never get a single-family home.
Right.
But if you have in your ordinance an accommodation that says, but by CUP, with the right reduction in density, and with the right other corrections, and with the right other waivers, it could work if you can sell it, if you can make your case. It's really not that different. The city of Norfolk's approach is not that different from other localities to be very strict with billboards and to make it a game of chicken, which is either be conforming or live with the nonconformity until the hurricane takes it down or something else happens. And so we are rather strict, and so this is opening the door a little bit to a world where it's not necessarily all or nothing. There could be, we will consider some modifications in some instances. But that's a policy question, and that's why I wanted to make sure we have your input on this.
Thank you.
Okay. On the next application, so much for the Jennif Shopping Yard. We've got a few applications here, and I'll explain it. But Jennif, as we all know, located on the east side of North Military Highway. So in the 1992 zoning ordinance, we allowed alternative signage by an overlay. So that was actually almost like a zoning district. So we worked with Jennif to do it was called a LASO, a local alternative sign overlay. So there's actually an overlay on that property now. We now do it with a conditional use permit. So part of this application would be we technically have to rezone it because we have to get the overlay off of it. So I just wanted to explain why it appears how it does on the agenda. It's a rezoning, but it's removing that overlay because we're really fixing the overlay, and we're doing it through the way you do it in the current zoning ordinance, which is by a CUP. So again, in 2001, we created the Jennif Localized Alternative Sign Overlay, and it was approved for Jennif. One of the things that it allowed is a shopping center identification sign for each principal entrance, 60 square feet with up to 5 shopping center signs. The applicant wants to keep the 60 foot, but wants to increase the number of shopping center tenants on the sign, so that kind of goes against what it said in the overlay, so we're going to amend that in this CUP. And then the second thing they want to do is, as we all know, there are shops within Jennif that are set way back off of even the ring road, and so to have the 1-for-1, which is currently allowed, 1 square foot of signage per linear foot of building, is really kind of small. You probably can't see it from that ring road. So to increase that to 2 square feet of signed surface area per linear foot of building. So really what I'm talking about are the buildings that face, if you can read it up there, the Charlie Delta and the Alpha. So those buildings there would be impacted by the wall signage. So this is their existing, and they all look the same. This is their tenant identification sign. You can see there are five tenants on there. What they want is that. So same square footage, but the names would be smaller because they're accommodating more tenants. And then this is an example of what it is they're looking for. This is an actual tenant that they're trying to work with to put in there. And at the 2 square feet per one linear foot of building, that would work for this tenant. And so they requested that it would be allowed on all of those frontages. Okay. Any questions on that one?
Called a LASO local.
A localized alternative sign overlay. Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
Let's go. Hey, honey.
Is that going away? Well, yeah, because we do it through a CP now.
Well, it's
we
only
don't
going.
Do it overlay
it's
anymore.
Only going away on the parcels with
oh,
the signs.
Oh, right, right, right.
Like it will still exist for some other buildings.
Correct.
That are still using it. That are not part of
the right, right. Yeah,
yeah,
as a concept,
it's
going away,
but
it will
still
remain
on this
parcel.
Parcel.
Yeah. All right, so this is the aforementioned applicant, the Elizabeth River Project, 4606 Colley Avenue. It's on the east side of Colley Avenue between 46th and 47th. So the zoning is CC, and again, we'll call them billboards. They're really outdoor advertising signs, but billboards are permitted by conditional use in the CC district with a whole host of locational criteria, I'll call them. So this is the site here. 46 is on the bottom of the screen. Adams Outdoor owns all of the property, and you can see the billboard in this photo. So that the existing billboard is on the last parcel they own on Colley Avenue before you get to the new, really well done Elizabeth River Project building. So what they're proposing to do is, and I'm going to say recreate because I don't think they're physically going to pick that sign up and move it. They're going to recreate it. Basically, one parcel down, it's 25 feet away to the south of where that one currently exists. So as Jeremy mentioned, under the new regulations, the outdoor advertising signs would allow the following by conditional use permit. The relocation of an existing non-conforming sign as long as no feature of the replacement sign shall be non-conforming to a greater extent than the existing sign, and allow a sign less than 500 feet from any other outdoor advertising sign located on the same side of the same street. And again, we would also get the landscaping, and the existing sign would have to fully come down. I try to do a graphic here, and we'll confirm that this is what they're going to propose. This was submitted when they initially submitted the application some time ago. So the red line on top of the screen is where the billboard currently exists, and then the one below it is where they're proposing to move it to. So we do talk about moving a non-conforming sign, and it can't be any more non-conforming. So just FYI, it's non-conforming as to size, location, so it's supposed to be 20 feet back, this is 10 feet back. The orientation, you're not supposed to be able to see it from any waterway. This one you can see from the Lafayette River. And then the separation requirements, as we talked about, not 500 feet from another billboard. This one was 135 feet from the billboard to the south. On the other side of 46th Street, directly on the other side of 46th Street, there is another billboard. Okay. Any questions on that one?
So they are going to increase the size?
No.
450 to
600. So that's what's permitted. That's what's proposed. They're not changing what is, I shouldn't say proposed, that's existing, I should say.
Okay, sorry about that.
Good afternoon, Commissioners. The next item on the agenda is the OV Beach Tavern, a conditional use permit renewal at 9659 First View Street, located on the southwest southwest intersection of First View Street and West Ocean View Avenue. It is commercial. It's an existing restaurant. The OV Beach Tavern had a 2-year conditional use permit. It expired, and now they're coming back for a renewal. And so they're also adding off-premise consumption to their conditional use permit request. So they've been operating with restaurant, live entertainment, and extended hours, and now they're also coming back for the off-premise. It's CC. In this district, you need a conditional use permit for restaurant with extended hours, live entertainment, and sale of alcoholic beverages off-premise. It's consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, which has needs to set as commercial. So their current operations, they operate from 11 a.m. until 12 a.m. midnight, 7 days a week. They're proposing to open at 10 a.m. on Saturday and Sunday, but 11 a.m., maintain the 11 a.m. That's a typo on my part. They're not changing the occupancy. They're not changing their entertainment. And they're only adding the off-premise, which I think they do for the takeout aspect of it, like ABC allows and has allowed since COVID started. Here's a picture of the site. Again, they've been there since 2021. They got a conditional use permit in 2021. They opened in 2022. The conditional use permit expired in 2023. They reached out to us and started working with us to get in this list. Again, their floor plan's not changing. On the left-hand side of your screen is closer to First View Street. You can see the outdoor dining area. And then inside, they have those two hatched-out sections there where they can put the entertainment. And then otherwise, you're looking at a bunch of other seats and a pretty large bar on the bottom part of the screen there. Both the Civic League and the Business Association have unanimously supported this application. They're very much in favor of them continuing to operate. Any questions?
Did you say it already expired?
Yeah, it expired. I think when they got when they opened, they thought it was 2 years from when they opened, not from the effective date of the ordinance. So it expired, and after, I don't remember if we cited them or not, but they came to us pretty quickly after and started working with us to get back through.
They came in to us.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I have the next one too. Sharks on Grammy Street. Excuse me. Sharks on Grammy Street. Conditional use permit at 4024 Grammy Street. This is the old Charlie's. It's on the southeast corner of 41st Street and Grammy Street. It's commercial, and the proposal is to allow a restaurant to operate with extended hours. It's consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, which doesn't need to set as commercial. It's zone CC, community commercial. In this district, you need a conditional use permit for a restaurant with extended hours. That should not be CM Chicken, sorry. They're proposing to operate from 11 a.m. until 12 a.m., 7 days a week. And then for the hours of sale of alcohol and for entertainment, it would be 12 o'clock noon until 12 o'clock midnight, 7 days a week. Their occupancy, they're proposing 20 seats outdoors, 93 seats indoors, and a total capacity of 125. Here's a picture of the site. On the left-hand side of your screen, you can see the exterior of the building. This is also located in the Riverview Pedestrian Commercial Overlay, so it'll have to comply with the signage requirements for that. And on the right-hand side of your screen, you can see the view on 41st Street. I did reach out to the applicant. They do not currently have an off-lot parking agreement. Their current parking is vested for 18 spaces based on the date of the building. So I think when Catch by the River came a couple years ago, they were required to have 18 spaces based on the size of their dining area. I reached out to the applicant to ask them what their current dining area is. I've not received that information back to try to figure out exactly what the parking calculation is. But they indicated to me that that they were told there's street parking and that there's parking potentially available behind the bank for their customers. I don't know if that's an agreement. I don't know if that's public parking, but that's where that ended up. And then I also reached out asking about the restaurant's experience. This is her first restaurant that she's going to own, but she's been a manager at several restaurants previously and worked in the food industry, I think, since 2015 as in a managerial role.
If you don't hear from them on the dining area, how will you know whether the imputed parking of 18 is sufficient?
They're going to have to get back to me on that before I can say definitively, yes.
And where would those 18 be allowed? Does that allow for street parking and...
So they're invested for it. So as a way to reuse existing buildings or historic buildings, I think this building is built in like 1940, I want to say. We allow them to be grandfathered for a certain number of parking spaces. So using this building means that they have 18 parking spaces counting towards their parking requirement right now. And that's based on the last estimate I got from Catch by the River. I'm waiting for the exact number to come back from them.
The calculation, then if they need 20, then they've got to come up to two spots.
But they can't count on-street parking,
yeah.
So they need to get parking off-street elsewhere. And their first phone call should be to John across the street.
Yeah.
Because if you look at an aerial, there's plenty of parking.
There's no site plan for this that show any on-site parking.
No.
And I wouldn't have asked the question if they were vested for 30 spaces and Catch by the River thought they needed 18. But since you're right at the line and since the vested amount was exactly the same amount as the last proposal, I'm just wondering whether...
Yeah,
you know,
I'm waiting for their...
They're creating a larger dining space, which would technically... practically, it wouldn't present any different experience for... customer, but just legally speaking, it's a box that we would have to check.
Yeah, one of the reasons we also recommended denial of Catch by the River, aside from the operational issues with that manager and ownership group, was the fact that they were proposing an occupancy of 215 people and only saying that they had a small off-lot parking agreement, but they're proposing a much smaller capacity of 125 people. So we are looking at it. A much different application. They were also looking at entertainment. This is just going to be restaurant extended hours of operation.
And this has been a restaurant since longer than I've been here, so very long time.
Venazio's or something?
Venazio's. I think it was open like 52 years.
Yeah.
So,
only that money dates back then.
I'm sure you appreciate that.
Yeah.
You probably don't. He'll have a story for you.
That's when we first had our meeting with the River View Business Association. The very first meeting back in 89 was Venetianos. Yeah.
That's good.
All right.
Okay.
The Islamic Center. This is going to be partially on 49th Street, and then there is one portion of it that goes in the back to Melrose. It is an existing religious institution, and they are looking to expand. Doesn't conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030, which designates it as a single-family traditional, and we do allow religious institutions in residential districts, so there's no conflict there. It is zoned SFT, which is single-family, and again, we do allow religious institutions by conditional use permit in the SFT residential district. I'm going to go right to my... I try to make a graphic... And I might step away here. So, I mentioned they began operating from the site in 1991. This was the original. 1992, we adopted a new zoning ordinance. We said
churches and religious institutions need a conditional use permit. Same year, 1992, they said we want to expand. This was the expansion. So from the blue, that was covered in their initial, special exception. Exception back then. So that special exception cover all of that. They are now back. They have since acquired three additional properties, this, that house, and then that house to the rear. So they now need a new conditional use permit to cover all of that. Okay. The other thing we're working with them on is, as you can see, the concrete. And the concrete here, that's probably not supposed to be, and as you recall, the concrete that we saw all in that front yard. So they are currently in site plan. They will have to remove a good, and you can see what the property line is and where the parking is. So they're going to have to remove a lot of that concrete. They're going to have to deal with stormwater. We saw on the field that they had the BMP here, so whether that's going to be enough to cover how much of the additional parking they're looking to get. We'll see. But they're not really expanding the facility itself. They've just added some additional single-family homes, which they will use for office. And then I think a member of the center does live, I think, in one of these homes. So that's what this is.
Okay. that's worth going out and looking at it, make a field trip.
This picture gives us an idea of their parking strategy for events. It's aggressive parking.
Yeah. And
it's
I,
one of those games we have to do.
That's pretty efficient. I mean,
you
yeah.
Can see it's more
you can get. I don't know which one you move first.
And I do have just some graphics. So this is going from east to west. So that's the house that will be included now in the CUP. And then you can start to see the existing facility. That's the existing facility. And I think if you see the concrete kind of, they're not really concrete, but the from that section on is the new section, or new 1992 section. Again, that's part of their 1992 CUP. You can actually also see the house directly in the background. That's part of their current CUP. And then this would be the other home that would be included in the current CUP. That's all I have on that one. Any questions?
Previous agreement that was in place was that they were able to park at Old Dominion University, and Old Dominion University changed their parking strategy
okay.
in the most recent years, which has caused them to try to adjust so they can get parking for their So that's kind of so been the reason why it's kind of, they've been trying to solve the issue, so just wanted to make sure that was you were aware of that as well.
And just to point out again, we noticed this when we were driving down 49th Street on a field trip. A good portion of 49th Street is home to multiple other types of religious institutions, so it is an appropriate use at this location. Okay.
Next on your agenda is Crown Castle Towers, LLC, for a conditional use permit for a communication tower at 211 West Government Avenue. It's on the southern portion of the property. It's on the south side of West Government Avenue between the Tidewater Drive underpass and First View Street. And again, they're proposing to build a 152-foot communication tower. It's consistent with Plan Norfolk 2030, designated the site as residential mixed. It's zoned institutional IN. in this district, for a communication tower, you need a conditional use permit. So here's a picture of where the actual tower is going to be going. So in the front of the building, you have the Columbus Club of Ocean View. That's it. And this is the back corner of that triangle back there. Yeah, I think it's called Columbia. Yeah.
Columbia.
It's nice of Columbus, but it's called like Columbia Club of Ocean View.
Okay.
So this is going to be in that back corner back there. So it's pretty far back and out of the way of the front of the building. So you can see again, this is that triangle here. This is their site plan. They're proposing full landscaping around it, consistent with like a minor site plan review. I don't think they're going to hit the 2,500 square foot of disturbance. One thing that they did include in their site plan that we're talking to them now about is the fact that they included razor wire in their proposal. We don't allow razor wire except for by a security plan. So I'm talking with them. They say razor wire is what they use standardly, but they're not opposed to using something else for us if the city requests it. So I sent that all information all over to them. I'm hoping they'll either go with a taller fence or electric fence, or if not, want to kind of get feedback on it and think about that. Here we have some renderings. So in the bottom right corner of the screen, you can see the existing view. And then on the top left is where the tower would be. And again, this is the view from First View Street. This is what it would look like coming up Tidewater Drive. And then this is what it would look like from Peachtree Street. That's all I have. So in the zoning ordinance, we have a series of review standards that this site needs to meet. Needs to comply with the federal regulations. You can't have commercial advertising signs on it. There are multiple users at the site. So again, the site is already used by Columbia Cares Columbus, but Verizon, T-Mobile, I think AT&T are all using this site. The site is current, the existing tower that's being used service, that services this area is in Ocean View Elementary School. So we're moving it from Ocean View Elementary School over to this site. So it's still within, it's within 1,000 feet of a school, but it's moving off the school where its site already is. So we're looking at that as a benefit to the community. And so it complies with all of the standards that we set forth in the zoning ordinance.
Razor wire on all sides
of the fence.
All sides of the property.
Yeah.
No, so just the fence, just around the tower, not around the property itself.
Okay.
They usually build a fence compound just around the tower and the supporting.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. But we're, again, we're discussing electric fence or a taller fence.
About that.
No,
just wondered, I know that the Navy was concerned about some trees
near Merrimack Landing, and I was just on my phone because I didn't go on the field trip, but it looks like it's like a few miles away, and I just wondered as far as their flight path, are they concerned at all about the height?
No, so the Navy originally had some concerns because they couldn't find the project. A couple weeks later, they looked into it more. They found the right project. They had some concerns about the crane during construction, but the applicant is working that all out with the Navy, and they'll all be squared away. Their plan itself is fine.
Okay.
And the one thing that I'll also say is that if there's a conflict between the federal aviation standards and our standards, the federal aviation standards will govern. So once the Navy says it's okay, it should be fine in terms of everything else for us.
Alright, so our next one is for a conditional use permit request to operate a homestay in a 4-bedroom single-family home located on the east side of Norcova Avenue, south of East Princess Anne Avenue in the Fox Hall neighborhood. It does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030. It is zoned SF6. It's an operation of a homestay. It require with more than 4 bedrooms requires a CUP to operate. So here's the site for the proposed short-term rental. This house was built in 1940 on a 7,400 square foot lot. The applicant will be adding foundation screening and a front yard tree. We're also going to require him to keep the curb and gutter area clean and require him to show consent for that shared driveway apron. The applicant has indicated that the property will be self-managed. He does intend to operate what you might consider a true homestay, where he's going to live there all the time and rent out a bedroom or two, not the whole property. So he's actually comfortable. We discussed adding a condition that would limit that so that he could only rent out 3 of his 4 bedrooms and he could not rent out the whole property. And he was comfortable with that because that's...
The condition doesn't require him to be there?
He would have to comply with the performance standards. So the performance standards say that if he's not there, he could rent out the whole house. But if he rents out anything less than that, he has to be there. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 500 feet, approximately 71% of residential parcels are single family, and 26% of residential units are single family. All inclusive, if this application were approved, 2% of residential parcels and 0.7% of residential units within 500 feet would be short-term rentals. As an additional note, the Fox Hall Civic League is not currently active. The applicant did conduct a self-hosted neighborhood meeting on October 13th, 2023, and he did have 2 neighbors that attended. Any questions?
Do the neighbors have any feedback?
One of them did not indicate any concerns. The other one saw his sign and wanted more information on how to start a short-term rental. All right. Our next one is for a conditional use permit to allow the operation of a conditional use permit to the operation of a short-term rental vacation rental in a 4-bedroom single-family home located on the west side of 20th Bay Street, south of Pleasant Avenue in the East Ocean View neighborhood. It does not conflict with Plan Norfolk 2030 in the Coastal Character District and designated residential mixed. It is zoned RC. All short-term rentals with 4 or more bedrooms in the zone require the CUP. So here we see the site for the proposed short-term rental. This house was built in 2016 on a 7,500 square foot lot.
The property is compliant with the tree canopy, foundation screening, and flood requirements, so no improvements to those natures are required. The applicant has indicated the property will be managed by Sojourn, which does operate other short-term rentals in the city, typically without issue. So for the neighborhood analysis, within 500 feet, approximately 60% of all residential parcels are single-family, and approximately 30% of all residential units are single-family. All-inclusive, if this application were approved, 5.9% of residential parcels, 2.7% of residential units within 500 feet would be short-term rentals. As an additional note, East Ocean View Civic League did indicate that they met with the applicant and voted to support the application. Any questions on this one?
All right.
One last one here. This is a request for a conditional use permit to allow the operation of a short-term rental vacation rental in a four-bedroom single-family home located on the west side of 15th Bay Street, south of Pleasant Avenue in East Ocean View. It does not conflict with Plan Offer 2030, also in the Coastal Character District and Residential Mixed. Property is zoned RC. It is a vacation short-term rental with four more bedrooms, which requires a CUP. So here's the site for the proposed short-term rental. This house was built in 2016 on an 8,400-square-foot lot. Since the property is compliant with the tree canopy, foundation screening, and flood requirements, no related improvements are required. Due to the configuration of the property, the applicant's indicated he will be storing his waste receptacles under those front stairs, so we're going to require him to put solid screening so that you can't see them from the street. We're also going to specify a location for his contact signage, which will probably be up on one of those railings there, to make sure that you can read it from the street without having to walk up the steps and look for something. He is going to be self-managing this property. He has identified a contact person that's going to be listed on his contact signage and lives nearby. That's going to be responsible for his 20-minute response time.
Do you know if that contact person has any SDR experience?
I would have to double-check. I don't think so, but I think she has some other relevant experience, but I can clarify that for you.
That's for the public hearing.
Yeah. For the neighborhood analysis, within 500 feet, approximately 55% of all residential parcels are single-family, 28% of all residential units are single-family. All-inclusive, if this application were approved, 13.3% of residential parcels and 13.7% of residential units within 500 feet would be short-term rentals. An additional note, East Ocean View Civic League did indicate they met with the applicant but did not take a position on the application. Any questions?
Thank you.
All right.
New business.
Okay. Headwaters Resort Casino. Located at 200 Park Avenue. It's on the south side of Park Avenue between the Amtrak station and Harbor Park. So originally in 2022, we reviewed a development certificate for the casino. It was approved by ARB, Planning Commission, and City Council. However, the applicant did come back and indicate that they were no longer able to fulfill that approval. They did come back again in July of 2023. However, after further discussions with the applicant, that plan wasn't going to go any further, and they are now back with a new plan. I will tell you, they were scheduled to go to the ARB on Monday, and very last minute, the applicant informed the city that they were not ready to move forward. So they did not go to ARB on Monday, so what I'm showing you is what I have. I don't know what has changed about it, if anything, but I promised that I would show you what I had, so I will do so. Again, it's in the DW, Downtown Waterfront District, and anything in that district requires a development certificate, which requires first ARB, then Planning Commission recommendation, and then if any waivers are needed, it goes to City Council. So here's what they've submitted. This is an overview. That's looking from Park Avenue. Kind of northeast from the Elizabeth River. That would be their main entrance into the hotel and the casino, kind of on the west side of the lot adjacent to Harbor Park. That's their outdoor space. You can see their seating and a pool area. This is their new site, smaller than their original site. And the city's flood wall will be on the outside of that property line. Just an overview. And then we start to go floor by floor. This is the first floor, which is parking. You then get up, technically the second floor, but this is where the casino starts. The casino will expand kind of two stories. You then work into the parking. And then you start to get into the hotel. And there's a combination of conference rooms and banquet halls and parking garage. I think this is trying to show the pedestrian flow of the site. And then we start to get into materials. And that's it. I don't know if I can answer any questions.
So, remind us, other than the design, what are we supposed to be considering for the design for the development certificate? What should we be evaluating?
So there are, and I'll include them, but I did that last time. There's a host of criteria that you're supposed to be reviewing. Actually, I didn't print them, but I had it in the last presentation, and I will make sure they are in the next presentation. And then the other thing is, I'm guessing they are going to be asking for waivers from certain things. So whether those waivers are appropriate or not.
As of right now, you don't know what the waivers are. Exactly.
I don't.
I expect that at this late date, you don't have the ability to exert any influence on them. It just seems like they've shrunk the site enough to make the waterfront property unusable. That concerned me quite a bit, but I don't have anything really to consider. Just, okay. Any questions of what was presented?
So will this get continued till next month?
No, they will have one shot at ARB on
ARB
the 22nd.
ARB meets again before the public hearing.
Maybe less enough time to review everything.
Question.
Well, and if ARB does not move it forward with a recommendation, it won't come to you, so it will be continued.
Although it would be good to get some detail on this ahead of pre-meeting right before the vote.
As soon as we get something, we can make sure that you get it.
So since ARB's meetings are not broadcast, are there rules against commissioners choosing to attend ARB as members of the public? I'm just looking at you.
There's no rules against it.
You just can't sit together, maybe?
There's no rules against it. My advice would be that if one or two of you you wanted to go, that you make arrangements that other commissioners not be there. The concern is that if more than two of you are there and it's not advertised as a public meeting of the commission, that even though you might not be talking, there's some unhelpful jurisprudence from the Virginia Supreme Court that says if more than the two are in the same place and public business is being discussed and the commission considers it, then that may be a public meeting. And nobody, certainly nobody in my office, but nobody in the Commonwealth is exactly sure what considers means. I've heard one attorney from another locality facetiously say that if three members of a public body all go to the same church and the pastor decides to spend his time in the sermon on some matter of public interest, that may be something that the members of that public body are then be deemed to have considered because it was discussed in front of them. So without some clarification from the courts and without clarification from the General Assembly, my advice is to stick to the two or fewer when gathered in a place where you know that public business is going to be discussed, unless it's your meeting, unless your meeting has been noticed for that location. So either stick to two or ask staff to advertise it as a meeting of the planning commission.
Let's make it a combined meeting.
Okay, thoughts on that? It'd certainly make it easier on us if it was just advertised as a public meeting.
Right, and it's not a public hearing, and it doesn't require all that. It's just a 3-day notice. They make sure we have it on the website, and we put it downstairs in the customary spot, wherever the clerk posts their boards and commission notices.
Okay, being concerned about unintended consequences, is that going to throw up a flag or create a situation that is unfavorable?
I don't believe so. I think it's fair to want to have as much information as possible. I would recommend not sitting together and
being hosted in the 11th floor again, up in chambers. So there'll be plenty of
difficult
room to go down. It's not in here because of anticipated crowd.
Okay, so off the top of the head, does anybody know the date and time?
27th.
At 4 p.m. Okay.
To clarify, Adam, do we have to do roll call of the planning commission too?
No. You just
no.
have to have, so not later than, I guess, Friday. I'm sorry. Today, three business days. You just have to put the notice at the immediate public of the city planning commission at 4 p.m. on the 22nd at the location.
Well, I'll email the entire commission, since we're missing a couple of commissioners, let them know the situation. But if something changes between now and the time of the public announcement, please let us know. Super. Thank you very much, Susan. Moving on, we have discussion items, consent agenda. Don't think there's anything that qualifies to be on the consent agenda, so we'll blow past that.
Could I point out one thing? Consent agenda, we have some ARB design review items that we didn't preview.
Thank you.
So we have before, for really simple things, done them as consent and not had the full presentation. It's up to y'all.
So on the top of the agenda, we have a couple of ARB items. Does anyone feel strongly one way or another? I'm willing to give my opinion, which is that we get a presentation, although, you know, not an extended presentation, and vote on them individually rather than as a consent agenda. I don't think that's going to chew up a lot of time. Thank you. So, who's giving the comp? Julie, are you doing comp plan?
Is that okay?
Who's here?
Yes. Do you see Chris's email?
Yeah.
I know Chris normally introduces you to do this, so he will be missed.
Oh, hi, everybody. I know Chris unfortunately can't be here, but we've only got one little update. On Tuesday, January 9th, the advisory committee resolution passed by City Council. This was just to kind of define membership and appoint certain members of the community. We've got a 28-member committee that will be the vice chair and the chair of planning commission will be two members of that committee. There's 18 organizations that are also a part of that, and each person from the stakeholder organizations will be appointed by the president or the CEO. So it's 18, and then 8 members that were appointed for each ward and citywide, so 28 total. We're shooting for the first meeting for our advisory committee for NFK 2050 to be in February, and the meetings we're planning on being quarterly. And when we've got the proposed meeting schedule, we'll make sure to run that by you guys, City Planning Commission. And pretty soon we're going to come out with a one-pager guide for the advisory committee members also. That one-pager is written by WRT. So they're going to have that for us, and that will just outline the duties and responsibilities of each advisory committee member, expectations. Probably we'll also have the schedule with that as well. So do you guys have any questions?
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
This committee is put together to advise the commission. It's not to advise the council. So at the minimum, they have to meet quarterly, but you can say it out loud because technically the resolution says it. If you find that their input is sufficient, then you can stop the committee as well. So just wanted to put that out there. That is part of it. If it's either the recommendation of the plan or if the commission feels that their input has been sufficient, then you and the vice chair can disband the committee.
Okay.
So.
No, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Going to freight containers, shipping containers. Jeremy Sharp.
Favorite topic.
Now it gets exciting.
Shipping containers.
Going to start off with these are just Amazon stock or Amazon. Google stock pictures. The one on the left is what we're talking about. The one on the right is a building, even though it's built out of shipping containers. I'm going to keep coming back to this topic, but that's not what we're talking about. That's in, like, Minneapolis, and it's really cool. It's a whole single-family house built out of shipping containers. All right, so we've been asked to discuss how to handle and whether we want to look at our shipping container regulations any differently than we do today. So zoning right now, we regulate them in a fairly limited fashion. We regulate an accessory structure called freight containers and shipping containers. That's not a defined term. I don't know what that means. So we assume it means what you think it means. It's something that's used for freight and shipping. So standard Connex boxes, intermodal containers, built to the ISO standards, you know, all that sort of thing that you would find in any Google search, does not include something that's been converted to a building using USB-C, or if there's some other relevant code that we might use, the mobile home code or something like that, doesn't include something like that. It's not designed to be occupied. They're designed to be storage or transport or freight. Also does not include the portable storage units, the pods, other things like that. That is a little more difficult for us because it's easy to say this was built to a building code or not. It's harder for us to say what's the difference between a pods container versus a Connex box. There's not really a difference other than branding and size. And I mean, obviously they're built differently, but a zoning inspector is not going to know the difference between those things. So we'll visit that a little bit again, and some of the research that we've done on this, a lot of communities blend the two together. So we need to think about how we want to handle that.
Just for a nuance for the commission, the previous zoning ordinance regulated pods only,
and that's how we enforce the requirement. So there's the city code allows for a limited time and amount, and I know Jeremy will get into this, a limited time and amount and a fee for the use of a pod. And that's what we use to say you can't have it anywhere else. Some point later after that ordinance, we were requested to add limited usage of Connex boxes or freight containers in certain zoning districts, which then a zoning text amendment was done to separate the two out from each other. And so that's what was written then. If it was poorly written, it's my fault because I wrote it. It was transferred over into the current ordinance made us.
And don't worry, Bobby, I'll rewrite it. So the current regulations are this, and again, as Bobby mentions, the regulations for pods, those are found in city code. And they do have time limits and fees, and I'll just be straightforward. Especially with COVID, they have not been enforced. They have been very loosely enforced. That I think is part of the conversation here. It's not specifically part of the request to look at containers, but I think that as we look at this, depending on how far we go, you probably need to revisit that, how we're doing it. The city code regulations are rather onerous, and so we may need to be looking at that as part of a greater look, potentially. So shipping containers, not permitted to be placed on any property in Norfolk except in these cases. Set of industrial, the heavier industrial districts, simply has to be outside the front and corner side yards, and then the bottom, the last bullet here, placed on a paved area, not have signage affixed. And we're not talking about the signage that comes with the container. We're talking about putting your own signage on there. So pretty limited in what we say. I mean, you can stack them. That means you can, as long as they're on a hard paved surface. These are your trucking terminals. These are the places that are coming and going, right? They also, though, it doesn't prohibit you from using them for storage of supplies or equipment and leaving them on site. The code makes no distinction between that right now. In the less intense industrial and business park districts, we have a few more regulations. Again, can't be in the front and corner side yards. Again, have to be on a paved area, no signage. May not be stacked. Only permitted for storage of goods and associated uses. That's in the code. If you're a trucking terminal, obviously we would treat you differently. And trucking terminal is allowed in at least some of these locations. And now must be screened from view because you're now looking at more of a, you're not looking at a deep water industrial port. You're looking at something that's a little more integrated in the community. And then we added a couple years ago the allowance for institutional districts. Probably more than a couple years ago at this point, but we added that an allowance for institutional districts in. We left them fairly basic, but must be screened from view, must be on a paved area, no signage affixed. That was, we were already seeing them, and we had additional requests for them. School sites primarily, they get used for storage of, you know, sports equipment and things like that. It's a cheap, easy way to do it. They exist probably in more places in the city than you think they do. So those are our current zoning regulations. Let's go through some examples. Not all of these are covered under the code. Not all of these are things we want to cover. Right here, Target was under construction within the last year or so. These were placed out front temporarily during construction with a building permit in place. These are not covered by these regulations. They have their own set of regulations, temporary regulations for construction sites. So this we have covered. I don't think this is relevant to our conversation here. We think we've got a good handle on that. Again, we talked about pods. We have city code regulations. They are a little overly burdensome potentially. We haven't done a great job of enforcing them. Maybe not a part of this discussion, but something that's kind of, I think, on my radar at least. This is a contractor's office. So this is industrial zoned. They are used, they're not loading up on trucks and taking away. These have been here, if you look at the street view history, these have been here forever. They are used as storage containers. Permitted in the district. They don't meet the requirement. They don't have the correct screening. They're not sitting on they're sitting on gravel and grass at this point, or what used to be grass. But this is something that essentially, if you did it right, the code would allow it. Here's our school site. This is Granby High School. These, I think, are largely conforming. They don't have the correct screening, but this is essentially what we amended the code for. It wasn't for these. These were there before, before we amended that code. But this is essentially a use. You know, I'll say I walk around this track all the time with my dog, and this is right on Newport Avenue. It's not the greatest thing to look at. A couple of shipping containers sitting there with the apartments right across. Behind this picture would be apartment complexes looking over at shipping containers. But this is currently allowed by code. This is not compliant. And I keep saying that because I don't have a lot of good pictures of compliant ones in the city of Norfolk. Here's one. I won't name the business, but I think it's obvious. This is something that's actually not permitted by code. This is inventory. This was a street view picture that was taken last September. They're stocking up for the holidays. This is what's going to go in and out. This is the common practice of these types of businesses. We try and go in, and Bobby knows, having sent inspectors out over the years, we go into the businesses, we say, hey, you really shouldn't be doing this. You got to get rid of it. And nothing in the code addresses this right now. Nothing in the zoning ordinance addresses this at all. Maybe it's a good thing. Maybe it's a necessity. We may need to think about that. Just thinking about our unintended consequences here. This is zoned commercial. If we allow them to be permanently here, they will permanently be here. These are in parking spaces next to the business that will not be named. This is my favorite one in the whole city. I don't know its history. I don't know where it came from. It's been there for a long time. This is two of them stacked, and they've got stairs to a door, and I think someone uses as an office. And it's been here forever, so I, as zoning administrator, I'm going to call it grandfathered. Not permitted, not potentially ever something we would permit going forward, but I always see this one every time I go down the street where you can see it. It makes me laugh every time. I don't think we want this, but this is, again, the law of unintended consequences. We have to think about what we're going to do here. That's a probably part of it, and if you look at the older street view history, it was much better painted. Yeah.
Is this commercial or industrial?
This is a commercial. Well, it's an industrial zoning. I think it's a commercial business. I think it's a contractor's office or a property management office. It's allowed. It wouldn't be allowed to be stacked under the current code, and I think I suspect there's a building code issue here.
Did happen to get a permit and it was located in the right spot.
If it did get a permit and now they meet an uniform statewide building code, it is no longer a shipping container. It is now a building and has to meet other requirements. So, I mean, this is what we're dealing with. This is just always my favorite one. All right, here's one. This is not in Norfolk. This is a Starbucks in Virginia Beach that is made from shipping containers. This is not a shipping container anymore. This is a building built to building code. So again, we're not talking about anything to do with this. Also just an example. I found an article when I was looking at this earlier when this was done in 2013. This was voted the ugliest building in Virginia Beach. But it was like considered extremely controversial, whether some people loved it, some people hated it. Thankfully now, I think to those who hate it, it's all grown in. This is an older image because you can barely see it from the landscaping is wonderful. This is on Virginia Beach Boulevard in
Great Neck,
right? I was going to say Little Neck, but I thought it was Great Neck. Yeah. All right, so this is another example of one that is no longer a shipping container, and this is not in Norfolk. This is in Scott's Addition in Richmond. This is another example of one that is a building permit, but it's a great example of what you can do. Here's another Scott's Addition example. Thank you, Austin. These are still shipping containers. They could still be picked up and moved. They have not been converted with building code. Fantastic use of it. So we need to look at what we want to do and what we don't want to do and how we want to address these things. Here's one in Norfolk. Probably a pretty good example. Still would be considered a shipping container, I think, because you can pick this up and truck it away right now. I'm actually not sure what they're doing. I imagine they're storing supplies and equipment in here. I actually don't know what they're doing with this. Maybe nothing. Okay, but this is an example from Norfolk. Doesn't seem to be bothersome to most people I talk to, but it's an example of maybe what we need to consider. Not conforming to any code right now. Unless it was built with a building permit, and I don't think it was. Not conforming to any code right now in zoning. But been again, like the other one, this two-story one, been there forever, so I'm not going to do anything about it. All right, so considerations, things to think about. So staff, Melissa on my team is who I mean by staff, conducted incredible research in November to determine how other localities in Virginia handle this. I think Melissa talked to every local government in Virginia, or at least tried, and there is very little consistency on this topic. Actually, interestingly enough, the regulations I liked the most, because they were thorough, was Gloucester. But they covered all the scenarios that we talked. They cover, and that would be my goal. Is if we're going to do something, we're going to cover lots of scenarios. But everybody's all. A lot of these regulations make no distinction between true shipping containers versus pods, versus things that are used for storage and maybe converted somewhat. There's all over the place in terms of regulations. We do need to think about temporary versus permanent. We treat them differently. And right now, again, that temporary storage outside the business I won't name is not covered under code. It's a common practice of those types of businesses. What do we want to do with that? You know, versus permanent, and what does permanent mean? I tell you, temporary people come to us talking about temporary all the time. Temporary is only as it is defined for that specific operation in code. There's no general temporary use defined in zoning ordinance. It has to be a specific thing, like the construction example at Target at the first slide I showed, that is defined as temporary for as long as the permits are active. So we'd have to define what temporary might mean. And if we're going to leave them temporarily, how long does that need to be? So we may need to think about those things. Modification, I don't think it's a shipping container anymore. I think we need to stick to that. If you're modifying it to a habitable space, it's a building. It's not a shipping container anymore.
You may have to define, does habitable space mean someone's living in it, or is it used for...
That's what we'll have to think about exactly how we play it out. But, yeah, I'm... Yeah, I think that would be living or office space, but that's more of a building code question, so we'd certainly want to talk to the building code office to make sure that we've got an understanding of that. Where are they appropriate? We do need to be careful. Right now, most industrial or all industrial districts allow them. Some commercial and institutional allow them. Do we want to broaden that out to more commercial, to the CC, the CR districts? Do we want to allow them in residential? Some of the communities around Virginia, particularly the more rural communities, these things are very popular for storage sheds. It's cheaper than going to Home Depot and buying the kit in a lot of places. So how far, I sense we don't want to go that far, but I think we need to make sure we're clear on that if we consider this any further. And then what kind of permit should be required? Again, permitting could be any number of different paths. I don't think we want to do CUPs for these. Administrative makes sense. A lot of communities handle them through the BZA. That's not something that Norfolk does. But a lot of communities do special permits through the Board of Zoning Appeals. There's any number of different paths. I think we would like to come up with something administrative to keep them out of your hair. But if we're going to do it, we're going to want to make sure we tighten them. So I know the request was to consider short-term rental. No. Sorry, habit. I know the request was to consider shipping container, particularly in more of a commercial type of setting. So that I think about, I wanted to make sure we covered all of the topics so we can know where we're narrowing from rather than starting narrow and going wider. So this is listed as a discussion item. So happy to be here for as much discussion as you like.
Well, I'll say that I prompted and asked Jeremy and team to consider this, and Bobby as well, because we've got these in our CC district in Ocean View. I'm disappointed that you didn't show those pictures, because that would have been great examples. Nonconforming.
I was trying not to be particular on one particular business. So
obviously, we want all businesses to be compliant and have a suitable use for these that also works with the aesthetics of the community and the business, and they're still, the use is the same, but they are used in a way that a little better than what Starbucks was trying to do, and that is they're there, you just don't know they're there, and they kind of blend into the background of the business. So I've spoken to Mel Price and her team about these a number of times, and I guess there was some work that was being done several years ago. I don't know who was leading that around, the city promoting the use of these, and I don't know where that kind of hit a wall or where it ended up. But that was kind of where I'm coming from. I guess we should be promoting largest port in one of the largest in the country. So certainly that would make this a suitable use for our communities, I think. So with the right parameters. So that's my 2 cents on that.
Yeah, I'm less scared of the worst use of a shipping container. more scared or concerned about us not taking advantage of the best uses of them. Shipping containers are all around us. We are not going to be able to screen our way out of the exposure to shipping containers. And they're generally kind of cool. Even the bad versions, I'm like, that's the most attractive thing in the picture. And the opportunities to bring color to the, it's really good. And not to look at another example, but you know, I don't know that DC is a good example or not, but DC has had some of the best use of shipping containers, and they are more inappropriate within the district than they are within Norfolk, and the Nationals Park and the Wonder Garden in DC are just amazing. And it concerns me that those things aren't being encouraged or allowed to happen more than, you know, some guy making an office out of one in an industrial park, you know, so what? So I would say, let's err on the side, personal opinion, of accelerating, encouraging the use of them. And let's not overdo the screening.
That's I was going to follow up on that. Your thinking is the screening isn't as necessary as...
My thinking is. And I think that we've gone too far for, like, on the HVAC stuff on the roofs, and I've seen screening that looks far worse than what it is screening. And I've sent you pictures. And I would hate to do that with even larger apparatus like shipping containers.
Sure.
I agree with that. I feel like there's an opportunity to be creative. I like the mural
style painting that you showed us from
the containers in Richmond.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe the screening isn't the most attractive thing.
Is there interest in, and I hear what you're saying about, you know, being a little bit more progressive on this, is there interest in moving into the residential side, or are we just thinking commercial?
I think both.
Okay.
Especially with ADU regulations that are coming in. Save costs.
Now, I do want to be, I think, again, if they are using them as, if they're converting into livable space, they are allowed today. So I don't think, I don't know that we have to do much with that. I think it's truly the shipping container as storage shed. And if that's something that we want to allow within a bounds, I mean, we're happy to explore that.
I think the line relative to the use is more important than the line relative to the location. As I'm just, and I may feel differently, y'all come back to us, but just thinking about it, if somebody's going to be sleeping in that thing, I want it to be permitted as a building.
Absolutely,
you know, with the building
yeah.
permitted and meet all the requirements.
That's what we.
Yeah.
Okay.
Question. What size is a square footage is a shipping container?
They're usually either 20 or 40 foot long units by
320 to 16 to 320 square feet.
Okay.
160 versus 320.
Yeah, that's right.
I was imagining, like, I've seen a few shows on tiny homes, and I wondered about shipping containers as tiny homes. And
It can all, again, if you can meet a building code to do it now, you can do it. I understand building code, and I'm not a building code expert, but I understand that building code is still somewhat limiting on how you can do those things in Virginia, but I think they're getting better at it, too.
You can Google that and see some very creative uses with restrooms and, style kitchen.
To Jeremy's point, the current... The current way the building code aligns it is that it can be used as essentially like a superstructure to something, but it's because it's not an industrialized building that's regulated by the building code, you have to have an architect essentially design it and show that it meets all the requirements. So there are probably other localities that are very, that have a more prescriptive kind of allowance for it, but that's currently where Virginia lies with it.
So I think if you want us to move forward, the next step would be to initiate an amendment. And I think we can craft it as broadly or as narrowly as you want. I mean,
or are we not there yet?
Or would you like us to come back kind of with the parameters that you've given us for further discussion?
Yeah, that sounds good to me. We're not going to vote on something at the next public.
Not to initiation yet, but
yeah,
more discussion. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are we good with that?
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
We discuss with ARB before it comes to the Land Commission?
I don't think so.
Good question, though.
I don't think we would go that long.
Historic district, yes.
Yeah.
That would be an amendment that would affect the historic regulations. That has to go through ARB.
Yeah.
Okay. But I will tell you, Susan, perhaps.
On the plot one at the corner of Main and Granby, we put a shipping container on its end, and it was a very cool thing in downtown for a number of years. And so we need to look at this as the best or good versions of itself and not kill it because we're concerned about the worst versions of it.
That's also why, to me, one of the important parts that we haven't really considered in code yet is that temporary versus permanent. And thinking about it, to me, the plot installations were meant to be temporary.
Right.
But code doesn't allow, we have to look at them as permanent because there's no other allowance. I think that may be part of it as well. And that gives us a little more leeway in some of our more restrictive communities like downtown or historic districts where you could do it for a period of time and then it has to go because it's temporary. And maybe that's something we can talk about as well, is what those lines mean.
Well, just push back a little bit, not all historic districts are, you know, colonial-style homes. One of them is called the Railroad District. There's a whole lot of industrial construction in that neighborhood, and it's totally appropriate.
Absolutely.
Okay.
We will, if you pardon my trepidation, Mr. J, having had to enforce these and sent out to deal with these, it is one that I am concerned of outside we will work on coming up with a solution for you and look outside the box.
Okay.
So.
Appreciate that. We're moving right on to your, would you like to make that, those your director's comments? Or do you have
one other item, Mr. Chair. So the, in front of you have a map listed. Paula reminded me that street closures come along, if we could keep you informed about them before they just end up showing up on your agenda. There are a number of street closures that are associated with Kindred, the St. Paul's development that's moving forward, especially as we're moving forward with the Blue Greenway construction and design. So here you have, I believe there's about five street closures that are under consideration that has been pushed forward for review through the process the city will end up initiating soon. Most of them dealing with the relocation of the streets to fix the street grid in St. Paul's, as well as removing some of them from depending on what the city attorney says, potentially removing some of them from the middle of the Blue Greenway. The Blue Greenway is under design, so that will come through the Architectural Review Board and to the Planning Commission for review for recommendation to the city manager. For those that aren't aware, it's not just the park. There are also structures and other things like that that deal with kind of community things that will more than likely be presented as well. So there is a pretty large holistic kind of plan coming together for that.
So Paula, I thought Freemason was going to be extended to Tidewater and a traffic signal put in there.
It is. So the beginning with Freemason right in the middle,
yeah.
That's actually going to be, I'm going to call it a finger of the Blue Greenway on the north side of the new Freemason that's going to extend the whole way over to Church Street, to the plaza. Remember when we approved one of the block, let's say 16, block 16, which was on the east side of Church Street. It was a plaza on the south side, this part of the stormwater system that drains into the Blue Greenway. So that's to take and move it from right-of-way into the park, yeah. The only thing that's an act that it's removing Ruffner, which is a little loop street that used to have some apartments on it that they've been torn down. That'll be in the middle of the park. The interesting one to me is Newton Creek Boulevard. It's that big fat thing between the post office and Tidewater Park Elementary School. It always shows up if you go into Norfolk Air. That's actually right of way.
Okay.
So, yeah. So it's just really doing some cleanup of what's underlying or network out there.
Even though that reaches the post office, that's not...
It does not touch the post office property. Yeah, both sides are city right now, which is why I want us to vacate it before we dedicate any land to anybody else. Yeah.
Thanks for the advance notice on these. And have we got a presentation on the Blue Greenway specifically at Planning Commission? I've seen it as part of St. Paul's and maybe ARB, but I don't... Can we get that on an agenda? That's a really impressive, it's something we should all be very familiar with.
Take care.
Yes, thank you.
Mr. Chair, there's one other item that I want to keep the commission informed on. Councilmembers McClellan and Spiegel, as you know, have discussed with the manager to continue kind of having a study group regarding short-term rentals. We're slowly working to try to get that meeting scheduled. I'm sorry, Mr. Bateman and Mr. Pendleton. Those meetings end up being the first Thursday of each month starting in February. There's a very robust schedule. I think Adam called it the best when you emailed me, that it's very ambitious to get through a lot of the information we're trying to get through. But there are goals to either simplify the process and as well as kind of get best practices of what we're doing well, what other localities have done well, as well as what we're doing not as good. So we hope to have some type of report back to the commission. I'm hopeful to get kicked free the other items that we've already discussed with Mr. Pendleton and Mr. Bateman that will help tighten up the process in the interim, which includes fixing the homestay definition as well as a few other procedural things that kind of deal with some of the things that people say slipped through the cracks. And so we'd like to try to get those forward, but I'd need to present those to this body and to ensure that the council members that are leading this also understand it as well. So to be continued, but we are working towards getting that moving forward again.
Well, I believe in continuous improvement. So the fact that this committee, we'll call it a study group.
That's what
it is. The fact that it's being created and y'all are participating in it is not an indictment on what's been done, in my opinion, in recent history. I think that this commission and staff have done a really good job addressing short-term rentals, and so I want to commend everyone and thank them for their work, and I appreciate commissioners who have volunteered to continue continually to improve our management of the short-term rentals. That it?
That's all I have.
Thank you.
Evening meetings? Yes, sir.
Monthly starting
February. You should get something from me next week. I just need to pin down some of the other internal city stakeholders. We do want reports from the Commissioner of Revenue, other things like that, which hopefully we can get those as part of the presentation. So we're talking holistically about how much money's been taken in, funding, kind of, is there a way to parse that out, other things like that. So.
Did you say a date that we should expect the report?
There's about 6 months of work that still needs to move forward, but we are hopeful to get the first layer of items kicked free soon, so hopefully within the next couple months.
Thank you. Commissioners, any comments? Mr. Melita, anything to add?
Yes, sir.
All right, we are adjourned. Thank you.